you guys for being here. How is everybody? How is Jacob?
I'm fine.
Awesome. How is Derek?
I'm okay.
Okay. How is Thomas?
I'm okay.
Did your new mic come in?
Nope.
Damn. How is Guaco?
Okay, I guess.
You sound very tired. Are you gonna make it?
Yeah, I just got out of bed.
Okay. How is Alex?
Okay.
How is... Where'd Sam go? I miss Sam, I'm sorry.
It's okay, I see how it is.
That's...
I'm just afraid you're being very nice. Like, this is, like, cause for concern, like...
I just right, wanted
I'm
to take a moment
dragons to, on you this round, so.
To remind everybody that, you know, it's a game, and sometimes the unexpected happens, and, you know, that if characters die, you know, that's just a thing that happens. There's ways in game to go about changing that, and if not, there's always new characters you can roll.
Checking in, making sure everyone's having a good time, everyone's doing well, everyone's had a good day, and also roll for initiative. And,
yeah. Basically.
Before you roll for initiative, start rolling death saving throws.
Hey, Malachi, how are you doing? Does it take this much thinking?
Am I good?
Oh my goodness. I asked how you were. Didn't ask you to write me a novel about how you were. Okay, fine. With all of that out of the way, and definitely the stream having started by now. Yes, Raiken, you can see it.
Yeah, I can.
Okay, good. Excellent. I can see that I have voice levels, so that's not a problem this time. Gonna make sure that doesn't happen again. It is time for episode 45. Of Everybody Loves Raiken. We are 5 weeks away from the big 5-0. I feel like something special should probably happen, but I've never been good about wanting to just insert stuff because of episode number. I just want the story to continue however it's going, but we'll see. Maybe I'll feel differently about episode 50. So definitely anybody who does listen to this, write in monsters you want me to sick on the party. They're just gonna randomly appear and kill everyone. Sound good?
They will appear in groups of 50.
53 million.
There's gotta be 50 monsters for the 50th episode. That's how it works. And there's gonna be 50 different kinds of monsters. That's 50 times 50.
50 different
monsters. It's gonna be 2,500 monsters. It'll be fine. It's fine. It's definitely fine. It's definitely fine. Okay, so, last time, you guys finally had your long rest. You woke up. You had breakfast. Jebel decided to disappear. Guess that whole lesson about talking to each other and being open and honest in your communication, giving people warning, didn't really sink in with the gnome. It's fine, right? So he disappeared. You all had breakfast and discussed what you'd be doing with the day. I will mention that Lynn, the local tabaxi thief, has made a point of, Notar asks, has made a point of trying to push the party toward getting out of Tuka. Like, are we done? Are we done? Can we go? We should get on that. Go. She has been pushy, I'll say. You got through breakfast, and Jebel reappeared. When Jebel reappeared, he had a raven near as big as he was with him, which he... I don't remember if much explanation about who, what, or why that raven occurred. I just know that it made a mess of the table, and then it stopped. And then the proprietor of the place came and made stir-fry for Jebel. Invented the dish, in fact. After that, the party went out to get all of the belongings they wanted to keep that were still on the wagon off of the wagon. That took some time, especially with all of the powder and buckshot and musket balls that Raiken and, excuse me, Vendar had stored away on there. and find a way to carry it with them. And then after everything of import was taken off of the wagon, Laramendis and Cyrus went to the Mages Guild to begin talking to Nalia. Yukikaze went to the postmaster to deliver the letter that Raiken had spent a portion of breakfast writing to his brother, Tatsuya, who is with the Nanaboshi clan out in the desert, and the rest went to try and sell the wagon, which they had a great deal of difficulty doing, in light of, the party, who was here did learn from the exchange, with the woodworker brothers, that they have reason not to deal with Vendar himself. And they tried to find some ways to work around that, but the brothers did not seem to be interested in risking their business. So they ended up going back to Ulfgar, the dwarf, and accepting whatever price he would offer for their goods. He seemed less than concerned with the disposition of the Drachner family toward him. So, having finally sold the wagon, the chest, its contents, the water barrel, and the Enolian, you are free of your burdens. And so one of the last things that had come up was that Leah was trying to talk to Vendar about his family and his past, and Vendar wasn't terribly inclined to have that conversation. But, excuse me, my throat is all nasty right now. I don't know why. Lynn, the tabaxi, was encouraging that this should be discussed, because it's part of that whole being on the same page and knowing what each other's issues are so that you can be prepared kind of thing. Man, she'd make a good Ionian. Anyway. So. I think being that we spent all of that time with this part of the group at the end of last session, I will start actually over here at the Mages Guild with Lair and Cyrus. So. You arrive at the Mages Guild, Laramendis, Cyrus, and the young half-elven boy from last time, you know, peers around the corner of the wall from his place at the desk and says, welcome! How can the Mages Guild help you today?
I would like to see Kalimdar if he's free.
I can find out for you, and I'll be right back. So he runs up the stairs, leather shoes slapping against the stairs as he goes. And after a few minutes, he will come back down more stately and say, Master Kalimdar does have availability to speak with you. Oh, damn. I forgot to ask who was calling. In any event, I can present you to him.
Thank you.
And he...
I'm Laramendis.
He was going to ask. He leads you up the stairs, and you take the turn at the platform and come back, and he brings you to the familiar office with the desk and bookshelves and that you spoke to Nalia in the other night. And he knocks on the door, and when Beta enter, he says, Master Kalimdar, Laramendis, here to see you with a friend. And, the Kalimdar thanks him, and he ducks back out as you head in. Kalimdar says, Ah, Professor, to what do I owe the pleasure today?
We are going to be leaving the city at some point today. So I was hoping, one, to say goodbyes and thank you for everything that you've done to help us with what we've needed to do here.
He smiles and says, Not at all, Professor. I did it for Nalia.
Give me a second while I roll. I'm sure she is very thankful for the help you have provided.
Yes, she has given me her thanks. So, what did you need to take care of before you left? How can the Mages Guild assist you on your travels, Professor?
I was hoping to use Ashe to speak with Nalia briefly to arrange when we would be going to Bromdor, and I was hoping that we could use the Mages Guild, or at least obtain the permission of the Mages Guild, or watching over of the Mages Guild for us to teleport, since doing that from anywhere else in the city seems inadvisable.
It would be ill-advised, Professor. Yes, of course you have the permission of the Mages Guild to perform what rituals you need to under the supervision of one of our agents. And of course, I will place one at your disposal. I, of course, have complete faith in you. That you are not doing anything that would be deleterious to the city of Tuka.
And, there's one other thing that I wanted to ask. Would you happen to have here the foci required for clairaudience and clairvoyance that I could purchase?
Let the DM quickly look up what those are.
It's annoying that it's a different one for sound and sight, even though it's the same spell in this edition.
Material component star, a focus, any focus worth at least 100 GP, either a jeweled horn for hearing or a glass eye for seeing, and that's listed under clairvoyance.
Clairvoyance is the spell, and clairvoyance gives you clairvoyance, clairaudience. They just don't have it. So it used to be, I think it was one spell that you just said both, like, the name of it was clairvoyance/clairaudience.
Well, I mean, I will say that the upside is I haven't noticed that it says it's consumed yet, so it seems reusable.
Yeah, it is. I think it says it's a focus. Yeah.
Yeah, it does say it's a focus. Various location. Sensor remains in place. When you cast a spell, you choose seeing or hearing. Now then, I need to look up Private Sanctum.
This is a divination spell, so it would stop it if somebody chose that particular feature of Private Sanctum.
Sound can't pass. Barrier, the warded area appears dark and foggy. Sensors created cannot appear inside it. Creatures in the area can't be targeted. Nothing can teleport into or out of. Planar travel is blocked. Okay. That was the last three that I really needed to know about. Okay. Cool.
It's a fun spell. I like it.
Yeah, no, it's very good. Okay. Yes, of course, Professor. We have a great many things at our disposal. Not so much with the magic items as you had needed before, but for foci and materials for spell casting, of course, we have whatever you may need, I think. So.
I will drop the... Is it 200 gold total? 100 for each.
It is. You need a focus worth at least 100 gold pieces, either a jeweled horn for hearing or a glass eye for seeing. And so, when you cast a spell, you choose seeing or hearing. You can use the chosen sense through the sensor as if you were in its space. It does not, unfortunately, actually state that you need both to use it either way. It does make sense that you would be looking into the jewel to use a visual sensor or using the horn for an audio sensor. See, when you cast, you choose seeing or hearing. Yeah, it just says that when you cast the spell, you choose seeing or hearing.
Yeah.
creature that can see the sensor, such as a creature benefiting from see invisibility or true sight, sees a luminous, tangible orb about the
size. Oh, as an action, you can switch between them. That's you. I didn't see that bit when I was reading the spell before.
I didn't see it either. It must be in the first paragraph.
Second paragraph. It's the last sentence.
Oh, I skipped right the hell over it. That is interesting. It's not directly written in there that you need both to utilize both. It does make sense from just a realism standpoint, but I'm not going
to
require that.
I think rules as intended, at the very least, you need, if you want to be able to switch between them, you would need both.
Okay.
So yeah, I'm going to buy one for each.
I'm not going to force you because it's not written, but I do appreciate the attention to that.
Cool, so that's that.
He will order some acolytes, some not acolytes, scholars, students, journeymen. Some journeyman gets the job of vending these items to you, and you will lose 200 gold pieces, I believe.
Yep.
Or 20 platinum pieces, whatever you prefer.
Yep,
to
I
make
pay for platinum.
Okay. After that exchange is concluded and everybody seems satisfied, Kalimdar is going to focus on Cyrus and say, and for you, sir, did you need anything from the Mages Guild?
No, I'm just here to accompany Alarmos.
I see. Well, if there's anything that the Mages Guild can do for you, please don't hesitate to ask, as it seems you won't have a chance again for some time if what I've been hearing from Nalia during her stay in the city is to be believed. Which I do.
I am going to put together a sending to Nalia. If you'll give me a moment to type that out.
While you do that, I'm going to skip over to Yukikaze, who's at the post. Where the hell did the post go? Oh, there it is.
What?
Yuki. So, there's a bit of a line to wait through. There's Humble and Grumble as people are trying to send and receive letters, especially, of course, as you know, in the wake of this attack by the Black Dragon, where several buildings around are melted or destroyed by the acid. I will say that on your way over there, you will notice that there is a great deal of work being done to try and repair buildings. You can see carpentry at work, scaffolding going up, and rubble being collected from places where buildings have collapsed. You also notice among this the excavation of bodies. So however it is that affects you, you do eventually arrive at the postmaster and wait in the line. It takes roughly half an hour to get to the front of this line, assuming you wait in the line and don't do something different.
So, was I... Trying to think of... I was gonna use my connections here to get the letter set properly.
I mean, yes, you could instead spend the time. It would take you about as long... maybe a little longer to find a Kageboshi.
Yeah, I think... Well, no, would I have any around this area, around the post office that usually do deliver? Would I?
I mean, it's likely that there is a Kageboshi who stations himself near the post, since people generally talk about news that they've received after they've read it, and so it'd be a good place to gather that kind of information.
I want to say that we do that if that's something to be acceptable.
Sure, I'm fine with that.
All right.
So instead, you will spend the time looking for the Kageboshi. And knowing what you do about how the clan operates, after a bit of effort, And looking for the right signs, you are able to find this building nearby that is being used by a couple dragonborn from your tribe. One of whom is, you know, of course, shrouded like he's prepared for missions in the dark. The building is unlit, and all the building, all the windows are like covered in you know, either boarded up or shuttered, so that it's quite dim inside. It's a little hard to see, but they come to you with candles, and one of them, who is lightly armored and cloaked, says, "Let me pull their accent back." He comes to you and says, "I am Kageboshi Onore, and you are from the Nagareboshi clan, yes?"
Just real quick, are we... hold on, just, are we using the one, my one tribe that I had the signs in the story for that kind of thing, right?
The Kageboshi.
I lost it.
They were the intelligence gatherers because they're the Shadow Clan?
Yes! Okay. Yeah. I can't believe I forgot that. Alright. I gotta find that paper, too. You said his name was
Onore.
Brother Onore, I need you to get this important message to his destination with guarantee, and I would like to request the skills of Kageboshi clan to get it to where it needs to go.
He raises his head to look at the rolled parchment that you're holding out, and then looks up at you, and in the shadow of his hood, but with the glimmering light of the candle, you can see that his eyes reflect back at you, yellow, in among blue scales, and he seems to take you in for a moment before reaching out a blue scaled hand and taking the rolled parchment reverently from you. And he says, "It is not often that we receive requests from the son of the Master of Clans."
Actually, this was a pretty important message from Raiken to his brother, right?
Yes.
Yes, it's a very important matter, that I do need this letter to get there post-haste.
This... Lumas family name I do not recognize. It is not one of our clans.
No, it is, one of my traveling companions, for the, my pilgrimage and... for a great matter to the world that we need to get word to his family. It's a dragonborn from the Seat of Bahamut, Arcosia.
Arcosians. I had heard that there would be... Excuse me, my throat is just not clearing. I had heard that there were dragonborn from Arcosia with the clans. I have not been back in some time. So forgive me. I will see it delivered. I will have to send ahead to let them know that I need to be swapped, and it will take a couple of days, but it will get there.
I appreciate it, Brother Onder.
Do you have any news from the clans? I haven't received anything since the dragon attack.
Not anything. I haven't received anything either.
But you've been to see them.
Yes, before we got back.
I had been told that you were traveling in the area.
Yes.
Is everyone okay?
Yeah, everything is going pretty well. You did get word about the magic storms ending, right? Or subsiding to a great degree.
Let's see, would he have had that information? Because it just stopped. No, that information wouldn't have actually reached him yet, because you rode as fast as you could to get here.
Get there, okay.
So he would say, no, I had not heard that.
Events that transpired in the desert with my traveling group affected the storms in the desert, and they have subsided quite a bit.
That is amazing. Perhaps we will not need to move camp as much as we used to then. That's going to change a lot of things. I hope for the better.
Well, all of the whole clan, or all the tribes will need to work together to change the way we do things. But anyways, yes, whenever you can get this letter as soon as possible, I trust our clans the most to get this where it needs to go.
He looks down at the letter again, kind of rolls it between his fingers, thinking. He says, yes, of course, as I said, I will see it there safely. Your father is soon to step down, isn't he?
Seikatz is coming soon, yes.
And you are to be his champion?
Well, I'm gonna be fighting for my right to be champion, but we don't know what the Shin Seikatz will hold.
Like many in my clan, I put a lot of faith in your father. He's done a good job leading the clan so far and keeping everyone alive, especially when some are not so inclined toward cooperation. So, I do hope that if it's you, you will carry on his legacy. I believe you will, so I hope it is you, is what I mean to say.
Well, thank you, Henry.
Safe travels, Yukikaze.
Do you need anything else from me before you go?
If there is no further news of the tribe to transmit, and no further news that you wish to transmit to them, you are not headed that way, but I will be.
Nope, that should be all.
I will say, Yukikaze knows that the tribes had been forewarned about the dragon coming and went into hiding somewhere. Presumably, this guy can find them no matter where, but that might be, like, something that...
Yeah,
Kageboshi...
No, Kageboshis are... They're the ones that keep all our special stuff in check.
But you could mention it to him, is what he's saying.
Or, like, a comforting thought of, like, they weren't... necessarily they weren't caught unawares by a dragon striking, and so they, because we didn't actually have confirmation afterwards, I don't think, that they were safe. I don't remember sending to your father after the attack.
Nope.
Which is certainly something that you could ask me to do when you see me next, if you would like to be aware of that information.
All right, in character.
Brother Henri, the tribes did know of the attack, some information beforehand, and went into hiding before things transpired. So,
you kind of notice that his grip on the rolled parchment tightens to the point that he creates a crease or two in it when you say that. He says, into hiding? in the desert.
That's true. We have our methods, Tristan, don't we?
From a flying creature?
Well, they're doing what they can to keep themselves safe.
If you have a way of contacting them, you should. Into hiding is a don't come looking for me signal.
I have a way, and I will do that then.
If you didn't know, then he must have been certain you would find one of us here.
I actually didn't think of that. I will get a message, or try to make contact with the clans post haste before I leave the city.
What is your pilgrimage? It carries you elsewhere.
We're trying to gather what resources we can to fight a green ancient dragon.
But not here.
Not here. We believe that's where the other dragon has gone to.
If your father said that they were going into hiding, then he definitely wants you to continue to focus on that. I'm sorry to have placed doubt in your mind. Disregard it. Finish your mission.
But I have many mages in my group that I could keep tabs on the tribes, and maybe I'll politely request a regular check-in with them throughout my travels.
He's going to actually step forward at this moment, close the distance between you, and reach his other hand out and reach it up to your shoulder. He is smaller than you. He says, regardless of what you learn, finish your mission. It's clearly what he wanted you to do.
Thank you,
Honore.
Honore. Well, I'm trying to think of how I want to word it. I will do my best in my endeavors to make our tribes proud.
I am certain you will. I have faith in the Nagareboshi. I am sorry I could not be more help. He seems...
But this is a big help, what you're doing now.
He seems very lost in thought. Like, he, even as he's speaking, you can see in the glimmer of his candle, his eyes are darting back and forth as he's thinking very hard about a problem in his mind. He says, yeah. Yes. It is my honor to serve the Nanaboshi in whatever way I can. He's going to open a pouch on his belt and gently slide the rolled parchment inside. Without closing it, he's going to put his hands together in the sign of honor, the sign of greeting from the Nanaboshi, and say, "Go with Bahamut, brother."
And you also.
And he's going to turn and slowly walk deeper into this dim place. You are free to leave.
And I will leave and start to head back towards the group.
So you receive a sending back from Nalia.
Sounds good. I will convey that to, I turn to Cyrus. In 2 hours, she will be available to speak. So, I suppose we should be waiting here until then.
Indeed. Care for a game of cards?
I've never been good at them, but sure. Is there nothing else that you needed done here? Any reagents that you need?
None of my spells, aside from one I no longer know, need reagents. Well, some require the more basic component, but nothing that I need to get specifically request.
Oh wait, I don't think I actually have the... No, I'm gonna pick up some herbs and herbs and I want to be able to cast Find Familiar.
Okay. Then you need incense and herbs.
Yeah.
I wonder if they have a scroll of Find Familiar I could borrow. Well, not borrow, but buy.
I'm sure you could ask.
I'm gonna go ask.
Okay. Are you guys gonna ask Kalimdar since he's probably still working in his office?
If he's still nearby, I'll inquire to him about it.
You approach, and he looks up from his work. He says, yes, did you think of something that the Mage's Guild could do for you?
Would you happen to have a scroll of Find Familiar?
That's an interesting request. Let me take a look. And he's going to pull a ledger out from beneath the desk and begin flipping page by page through it. He pulls out a small pair of spectacles as he does so and holds them before his eyes. He says, yes. Yes, we've got a couple, but there's a special note here. If the familiar is destroyed, rather than momentarily banished, I forgot the word for it, dismissed, then you would need to cast it again, and you would need another scroll if you can't cast the spell.
Indeed. Is there any chance I could purchase one or two of those?
We have three, so yes, you could purchase two if you want.
Might I ask how much?
Well, it's going to cost... 125 gold pieces each.
Each.
But there's no material cost because the scroll provides that.
Neat. I'll have to wait till the rest of my group gets here, since I don't have enough for a purchase of that size on my own, but I expect she'll be agreeable to it.
Very good. Well, just know that if you ever need more of the scrolls, we can sell you more. I will put in an order to have more produced.
Thank you.
I can just pay for them.
Okay. I don't know. I didn't know you were rich, so.
So.
If you want to cough up the cash, sure.
I will pay for that, and then I'll be buying, I think, 3 sets for, like, 3 casts of the spell. So
you're going to buy them out for Find Familiar?
Or no, the incense? Or I can buy one of the scrolls for him.
Okay, so one scroll costs 125, and then however many casts you want is 10 each.
Yeah, so I can buy one of the scrolls.
Okay.
Now, and then we can see if others can help make up the difference for your second one, if you would like, and that way you can cast the spell before they get here, so it's already done.
Alright. Thank you. Now I need to pick familiar.
Mm-hmm. Alright, so you're going to drop... How many castings did you buy?
I bought 3 for me, and then there's 1 scroll, so...
Okay, so 155.
Yeah, so I will need 5 gold as change.
Okay.
I have mostly platinum.
All right. But... Deduct and add as you need to. Yuki, where would you go after having this interesting conversation with Honore? Yuki?
I hope I unmuted myself. So, I would either... I think... I would head... Probably to the Mage's Guild, now to think about it, because that's where the teleporting is going to happen. And I know that's a stationary location, instead of hunting down the party. So, I'm going to go Mage's Guild.
Okay.
See if I can meet up with Armandus and Cyrus.
Okay. When you get inside, the young half-elfin boy is going to greet you again. Welcome to the Mage's Guild, sir. What can the Mage's Guild do for you today?
I'm here to meet up with 2 of my traveling companions, Laramendus and Cyrus. They happen to still be here.
He's going to pause a moment and think. He says, yeah, actually, I think they're upstairs. I remember giving Laramendus' name to Master Kalimdar.
Would you mind taking me to them or letting them know I am here, please?
I can take you to them.
Thank you very much.
And he leads you up the back staircase, the platform, then up the next staircase here. And you will find them being seen to by a couple apprentice and journeyman mages. As they appear to be buying things. You can see that there is exchange of money and, like, it smells very strongly of incense in here right now.
Yeah, alright. And I'll say, hey guys! I've done sending a letter. Figured I'd meet you guys here.
Excellent. We're just stocking up on some reagents and foci that should prove useful.
Alright. I don't really have anything to do here, so I will just chill with you guys until we meet up with everyone else.
Okay.
We will be able to speak with Nalia in, I give the remaining amount of time.
A little less than 2 hours.
Okay.
To be able to coordinate when we will be leaving the city.
Oh, actually, is there a spot where good that I could sit down and read? I pull out one of my books. I don't think I gave them to Leah to hold on to.
Oh. I mean, you would have gotten them back because you bought a backpack. So I imagine that once you bought the backpack, you got everything that you wanted back.
Okay, yeah, I have the books and the maps for the Underdark. I think I want to... I'm speaking this as out loud to Lemus. I think I'm going to read those books while I wait for everyone and whatnot. So...
I'm saying that in character to you, just so you know, guys.
Yeah. I'm sure that we can find some place for you to sit down and read. Well,
I could find a spot, just I'll be over where the Mage's Guild has a spot where I can chill. I'll ask that attendant that helped me out, maybe to direct me to a good spot to read out of the way.
Yep. They can direct you to a good spot that's not in anyone's way. It's like off to the side on the first floor.
Okay, so I will...
By a window.
Alright, I'm gonna go do that, and just come get me when you're done, guys. And I'll mosey on and do that.
Excellent.
Anything else for you three, Cyrus, Lair, Yuki?
I'm going to find someone to ask them to oversee me casting Find Familiar, just so I can have my familiar already cast.
You have the journeyman who's assigned to you in this case. Anytime you want to cast spells, you will indicate it to him, and he will oversee the casting.
Also, I do that and finally have Kyoko back.
You can see that he is, every time, he is preparing to counterspell you. And when he runs out of, if you were to cast enough that he would run out, you can imagine he would be replaced with somebody who has more spell slots.
I'll probably join him if allowed to also be, casting Find Familiar from this role, so I can have that out of the way.
Okay, have you decided on a form?
I have not just yet.
Okay, let me know when you decide on a form and a type, and you can DM them to me.
Will do.
And we'll hammer out the details. Alright, so, you guys, during this time... Hi. Let's stretch out of the way. Over in the market district, you have just sold your wagon and its components, including the Aeolian. And as these would be taken in, Jebel, you would hear the Aeolian remarking on the other animals that are inside, responding with both curiosity and fear.
What does it say?
The Aeolian, as it's led inside, says, "Oh, new friends! Oh, that one doesn't look so friendly! That one doesn't look so friendly!" And you can hear other voices inside going, "Ah, new meat."
You've sent him to the glue factory. Congratulations.
We'll take good care of you till you're sold.
I'm gonna.
You're gonna what? It broke up.
I'm going to follow.
Follow? As in go inside?
Yeah, see what's going on.
Sure. Inside, there are all of these different stalls, basically, penned areas. The only creature here capable of flying appears to be this wyvern. And there is a scorpion. Both of those are more rather caged in, so they can't get out through the top either. The wyvern, while he's in here, seems to have his wings tied. Or he walks on those. That wouldn't work. Excuse me a moment while I think about that. Well, anyway, the cage seems ample. He appears to be the one talking to the Enolian that you've just sold about being kept company. The dwarf is just locking the thing up and putting some food in with it. The cat meows as you walk in, and it seems to stare at you with its bicolored eyes and say, "You were already a customer."
Who said this?
The cat.
Is this the cat from the inn, or is this another
No, this cat? Is a new cat. The cat from the inn would say, "Hey." This black cat with two different color eyes.
I'm not just gonna look the guy. Hi there.
He says, "Didn't you already get what you needed?"
I'm checking to make sure that my friend here is looked after.
We're definitely looking at him.
Looked after, not looked at.
He's going to move over into your square and begin rubbing his head against your legs as he moves around you. Where is a range? Send to back. You smell familiar, but I've never met you.
Yeah, I've been getting that a lot recently.
Your conversation with the cat is going to be interrupted as the dwarf, still hanging one arm, holding the feed over the side of the stall, says, "Are you talking to my cat?"
Yeah.
You're freaking me out, mate.
Sorry?
Mittens, get over here. The cat's going to circle you once more. Why do you feel so familiar?
I'm a druid. The other animals have called me a natural.
It sits down, like it moves toward him, then sits down and begins licking its paw. And it stares at you. You can see its eyes, the irises working, dilating and constricting in the light as it decides, as it gets a feel for you. And, says, "I've heard some stories, but I've never met one like you."
Like me?
Well, I've never met a natural.
Okay. I get you.
Not, I've never met a natural like you. I've just never met a person like you, being a natural.
Yeah, aren't they kind of rare?
The dwarf is again going to interrupt. He's like, you're still talking to my cat, mate, and it's still freaking me out. Can I help you with something?
I just came in to make sure that the Enolian was going to be looked after. Well, he's a bit freaked out.
He's going to look at the Enolian, look back at you, kind of finish shaking out the food very quickly into the trough, and pull the feed bag back over and set it down and kind of look at you a bit grumpily and say, "Are you telling me my business? I look after these animals every day. Otherwise, I won't get a good price for them. So it's actually in my interest to take good care of them, and I don't like you insinuating that I don't do that."
Okay.
"Now, is there something else I can help you with? Can I interest you in one of these fine animals?"
Well, I'm gonna glance around and then No, I don't think we can take anything with us.
The cat's just licking its white paws. It's got little socks. And he looks up at you again and he says, he's not great at taking care of the animals, but I make up for it.
How?
If he forgets to feed them, I see that it's done.
Forgets?
It doesn't happen too often, but you know how humanoids are.
How are we?
Unreliable. Dull. Slow-witted. You can't even catch a mouse. It's very sad. So I take pity on him. I help him out. My job's very important. All of these animals, they look up to me.
I look at all the other animals down here.
I was gonna say, the dwarf is gonna say, forgets! Forgets what? What are you talking about?
I think I hear my friends calling me. Alright, I got to go. Keep them safe. Bye.
He looks very haughtily at you as you leave. The hells was that about? You just hear the cat meowing and I'm like, you're the only one who understands me, Mittens. You come back outside. So, momentarily, Jebel had gone in, and you could hear that it got a bit heated because it's canvas walls, pretty much. The door's right there anyway, even if it's wooden walls. So, Leah, Raiken, Lynn, and Vendar.
You're saying it's got hot? Like,
I'm glad to know you're paying attention. Jebel came out of the bestiary, and while he had been inside, you could hear him arguing with the person in charge, who is a loud dwarf who sounded angry.
Yeah. Oh, okay, so it meant heated as in...
angry.
It
sounded like a fight.
Gotcha. I thought it meant that it was getting heated for us and got confused.
Jebel, what are you doing in there?
Oh, the Nolian sounds a bit, unhappy. So I just wanted to make sure that he's going to be looked after.
And what was the verdict?
We should leave.
like, right now?
Yeah, let's just go.
Alright. Does anybody need to go anywhere, or do we want to meet up with everybody?
I have to go to the post office.
Alright, let's go to the post office.
Okay. It's gonna take you about an hour and a half to get there because you get to cross all of this city.
Yay!
Down to the main road.
Even with my help?
Are you going to take them on?
The last time that we took your help, we got knocked out. In a back alley.
I mean, it is a legitimate concern, Leah.
Listen, it's not bound to happen every time.
We don't know if there's more of them.
We don't need to risk it.
Okay.
I appreciate your trying to help, though. Let's just play it safe.
Lynn is going to chime in and say, after your group broke up the Sand Dollars, they were quite resentful, as you should be well aware, but I only know that this Jebel is acquainted. Rodal is a very grudge-holding member of that former group. I think that it is probably risky to travel unprepared in places where they could lay in wait, seeking revenge. It is possible that they are not there, especially in light of recent events. However, I don't think that I would risk it. They won't jump you on the crowded streets of the city.
Did you say he left the city?
Unfortunately, as far as this one could find, he is no longer in the city. And it is, if it is true that he absconded with as much as you have indicated it is worth, this one would not stick around either. That is a rather large nest egg with which to make a new life. And it seems that, being as magically inclined as Rodal is, he could afford to get out of here with haste. Much as we are doing. All of my contacts that I could speak to in regard to Rodal indicated that he was not available.
Well, it's clear that our haste is not as sufficient.
This one thinks that Rodal saw the writing on the wall and made good on his escape.
He left the city. We're leaving the city. Maybe he won't have made as good on his escape as he thinks he did.
It is possible. If he goes to a place that you end up, it would be most unfortunate for him. But if he has gone anywhere else in the world, he is now a needle in a stack of needles.
Are we really leaving the city? Because so far we've just been walking in between two locations.
This one certainly hopes we are leaving the city. The city is dangerous. Why are we still here?
I'm pretty sure we're going to go to the Mage's Guild after we post this letter and leave right then.
This one hopes that is true.
I feel like we should have left right after breakfast.
This one agrees with the small child.
We had things we needed to do.
More important than getting out of here and interfere
with
the
cart.
Stuff.
I gotta post this letter. Important.
You have this discussion as you wait in line, and eventually you make your way to the front. The half-orc behind the desk and his tired-looking half-elven compatriot, or wood-elven, I think she was, actually. Let me double-check that. Wood elven. She's still covered in bird droppings and looking tired. Let me think. It would be... It's getting close to noon. The half-orc turns and says, "Welcome to the Postmaster of Tuka. What can I do for you today? Do you have letters that you are sending or receiving?"
I need to send this letter to Everwatch and Aspara.
You just hear an "Ugh!" from the wood elf behind the counter. That was very well. Aspara. El, do we have any birds for Aspara left at this time? There's a short pause before she goes, "Plenty. Nobody's sending letters there right now." "Well then, I think we can help you." So, sending a letter to Aspara. And he takes out a small slip of paper and a quill, and he seems to do some calculations and writes them down. Rolls them up and says, I can take the letter from you.
Okay, I'll hand him the letter.
And he's going to turn it over and say, Lilith Drachner. Well, that's, you're sending this letter to Lady Drachner.
Yes.
And at this, the wood elf is going to finally approach the counter and say, you know, he looks just like the guy from the... I can see that now, El. I'm not certain that we can help you with this.
Seriously?
Well, I'm certain you're aware how powerful your family is.
I just need to get this letter to my sister.
Alright, but you're gonna have to make it worth our while, because if this comes back to bite us, it's going to mean bad things for the city.
I can make it worth your while.
Get 100 gold from him. It's going to cost a lot more than that if she does what I think she'll do about this letter. Well, how much do you think he's good for? He's going to clear his throat and turn back to you and say, given your intimate familiarity with the situation, what would you say this letter is worth to you to reach your sister via us, and not perhaps by some other means?
I don't know, can I roll for that?
I mean, he's asking you what you think you want to pay for this. He's saying, what's it worth to you? I'm not sure that there's any, like, role that would help you understand the monetary value of this, because he's asking how much does it mean to you emotionally.
I'll pull out a ingot of platinum. Platinum ingot. I still got one left.
Okay. So you just, like, go through your bags. Come on. You just pull out this 1 pound slab of metal and bang it down on the counter. I assume. I don't want to put your actions in your mouth.
There you go.
Okay.
You think this is enough?
The, Elle is going to, like, crowd up next to her half-orc companion and like, stare at this gleaming silvery metal. And, the half-orc is going to swallow and say, I think that'll cover it. He's going to just sort of slowly reach his large greenish hand out and slide the ingot back across the desk. Very slowly, waiting to see if you try to take it back from him.
No,
okay, he's going to let it slide off the desk, the counter, and put it on a shelf underneath. You hear it bang down. He's going
to
say,
"The letter better get to her."
He's going to finish the little calculation he was doing on the piece of paper, and then he's going to crumple it up and drop it on the floor. And he's going to take the letter and say, attach this to our best Asparin bird, if you would, El. And she's just sort of going to absentmindedly take it, while you can tell she is still staring at the platinum ingot behind the counter. Is there anything else we can do for you, sir?
Nope, that'll be it.
The rest of you? Any of you have letters you need to send or receive?
Nope.
All right, then. Thank you for your business. The postmaster of Tuka wishes you a good day.
Thank you. You too.
And then, where do you go?
Heads into the Mage's Guild, right?
That is a good plan. Does anybody else have a different plan?
Did you go to the Gambist yet?
The what?
The Gambist. Oh, right.
We have to trade our gold for platinum and shit. Forgot about that. Where is that?
You need to leave. I hate standing in lines. It's a bore.
It's not like we do it often. So I guess we go to wherever the money transfer date is.
Okay. The people at the postmaster can tell you exactly where it is. It's actually not too far. It's still in this district.
Good.
And you go to a rich-looking building that has images, like, fly a banner outside of it that has, like, gold coins, copper coins, silver coins on it, seeming to be falling in that order. And then at the bottom, like, what looks like a brighter silver, so probably platinum coins. Showing that it's turning all of these things into platinum. It's pretty easy to pick out. Inside, it's well furnished. There are plants all over the place, and there are high, high windows letting light in. Large and thick paned, made of glass. Inside, there is a gnome. Who is behind a very low counter, almost like a table that he's kneeling at, so it's very, very low to the ground. And he has several, he's got his own little cube of shelves around him. And there is a tiefling male in there with him. And as you enter, the gnome sitting at his very low desk is clearly doing computations on a sheet of paper, and he has an abacus with him that he's doing out math on. And you can see he's got a couple of stacks of coins in front of him that may or may not be part of what he's working on at that moment. The tiefling will look over and notice you, and he'll say, "Hello, and welcome to Gold Exchange Cambistry. What can we do for you?"
"We need to exchange some gold."
"Well, then you've come to the right place. Master Luten here is an expert cambist and can convert any sum you have into any sum you want. We also have a decent stockpile of any coin you might need to convert into, but be aware that our... depending on what you're converting, we may or may not be able to meet the needs if the demand for copper is high. We can only keep so much in the building."
"I don't think that'll be a problem."
"Very good." And he's going to kind of gesture you to the spot in front of this very low table. Like, you will have to sit down, and it will still be a little bit low for you to deal with. And he's going to approach and very, very gently and softly, come up to this, this gnome sitting there and say, Master Luten, we have guests, we have customers. They wish to exchange their money with you." And gnome continues mumbling to himself and scribbling on his parchment, and the tiefling will very hesitantly reach out a hand and just gently pinch the back of the quill as it's moving, and you'll notice as it catches in his fingers, a figure gets messed up by the dragging of the pen as it gets stuck. And Lieutenant goes, "Ah! My calculations! What have you done?" And again, the tiefling releases the quill and says, "Master Lieutenant, we have customers who wish to exchange money? Now?" And Lieutenant, still glaring at the ink scratch across his page, goes, "What's..." And looks up and seems to see you all for the first time. He says, "Oh, my, yes, quite a lot of you large folk, aren't there?" He seems to stop as he straightens himself out and looks over at the tiefling, kind of half glaring. Says, "Thank you. That'll be all." Tiefling takes a few steps back with his hands before him, palms out, and Lutan adjusts the spectacles on his face and looks up at you, Vendar, and says, "All right, well, tell me about it. What's the sum? What have you got? What do you want to exchange?"
Leia, wanna get it out?
Oh,
Leia, show the man.
Okay, let's take a look at this. Why did not prepare that one page? There we go. So there's 6,554 in the bag. And I need to take out a little at a time for it not to just overflow.
Okay.
You just can stick pulling out handfuls for like an hour.
It's gonna take a little bit, yeah. I will say that in the meantime, someone could go to the Mage's Guild to inform the others of what's happening. But I do believe that this whole transaction will take roughly a half hour, putting you at the Mage's Guild just in time for this meeting with Nalia.
Yeah. How much of the money do we want converted?
How much did you say they were?
Well, Leah don't know the exact number. It's 6,000 or so. Maybe more, maybe less.
Keep going until we run out of gold.
Okay, then. I'm gonna take a little
maybe,
at a time.
Maybe keep a couple hundred gold.
Yeah.
I have some gold.
I see. I can exchange any currency you have for any currency you want. I have coinage from at least 5 different countries. 6, Master Lieutenant. I have 6 different countries readily available at this time.
Yes. So I will take out until everything is out, because I figure might as well, then we know how much is in there.
So he's literally just watching as this pile of gold increases and increases and increases.
Eventually we can't see the gnome behind the desk.
The table's piled to the floor, to the roof, and it's like...
could you put in the chat exactly what you have? Gold coins, silver coins, copper coins. Anybody who wants to do an exchange, and I can tell you what you'll get back.
There's actually 10 platinum coins as well.
Right, but those don't convert to anything currently.
Yeah, so I need those.
We'll probably eventually need to reintroduce astral diamonds or something similar.
Oh god.
We're just too damn rich.
Just compressed residuum.
I mean, you have residuum, which also... Oh! Leah, I need to send you something very quickly. But please, keep getting your money stuff put together. Anybody who wants to convert, and I recommend you convert if you're carrying more than, like, 300 of any kind of coin.
Yeah, I think my silver and copper will just stay. I've rolled them in there, but the numbers is too low for it to be worth converting.
Yeah, those numbers seem reasonable to still have.
The only thing I have more than 100 of is plat.
Jesus Christ!
First
Mr.
Reference.
Moneybags over here. Bailey disowned him, but he's still rich as hell.
I may have to stop being Drachnir, though. Pick up a new identity.
We've already decided that one, though. It's Drakfar.
That was so bad.
I think we remembered that last time.
Oh my god.
Maybe just Drakfar. Just
that was gonna be Drakfany. Instead of Franthony. Drakfany.
So, do you have your monies? Let's see here. Okay. We got Leah's and Jebel. Did you, you had 400 gold pieces, is that correct?
Yeah, I'm trying to just work out a way to have some of everything.
Some of everything. Okay. Then let me know. Alright, so Leah, you have produced 6,554 gold pieces, 21 silver pieces, and 28 copper pieces. And he's going to slowly count his way through this, and it does take some time. He's very exacting, but you can be confident that he's got the right number at the end. And he's going to to straighten his spectacles on his face and say, "All right. Do you want to keep any of the silver or copper pieces for any small transactions, or shall I convert it all up to its smallest denominator?"
That seems small enough to keep.
So you'll keep the 21 silver and 28 copper?
Yes.
I think that's reasonable, especially if you're going anywhere that isn't Tuka. Tuka functions mostly on platinum, though.
We are going anywhere but Tuka, so...
Well then, excellent. 399 and a half. Yeah, I think that's accurate. Okay, so you'll be able to get your conversion, especially since you math it out yourself. He double checks your numbers, and gives you those numbers. Then, Jebel. In the end, Leah, you're going to have 655 platinum pieces. And 650 divided by 50 is 12, 13. So that's going to be 13 pounds plus the extra 4 gold pieces. So that's going to work out to another pound between the silver and copper and gold. So you're looking at just over 14 pounds worth of coins at the end of that, having 655 platinum pieces, 4 gold pieces, 21 silver, 28 copper. Okay? And I'll write it out.
Yeah, write it down because I lost track.
Whoopsie, that's supposed to be a P. 655 platinum, 4 gold, 21 silver, and 28 copper, because you wanted to keep those rather than convert them up. So he just converted your gold into platinum, and he converted as much of it as he could. Now, if you prefer ingots to 50 coin stacks, he can provide a few ingots in their place, but they weigh the same amount.
Okay. I'm gonna leave that decision to the rest of the group, because...
Now, the rest of the group right now is Vendar, Jebel, and Raiken. So does any of you have a preference over whether it should just be a stack of 600 coins, or if there should be a few ingots of platinum to break it up, just so that it's less coin? It'd be the same weight at the end, because one ingot is 50 coins, and they weigh the same. One ingot is a pound, 50 coins is a pound.
I would get a few ingots. Just
three ingots, 405 coins.
Yeah, just so we're not doing the whole thing with the gold coins like we just did. To pull out a million of them.
So, you said 5 ingots and 405 coins?
What?
That's how it works out, right? Yeah.
It should, because it's 50 each, so 5 ingots would be 250.
Yeah, that sounds good.
Are you good with that, Leah, then?
I'm trying to write this at the same time. What did you say?
Okay, I'll do it this way. 5 platinum ingots, 405 platinum pieces. We'll just do that.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah,
that's pretty much it.
Seems to be fine.
Yep. After all of this, lots of counting, and then finally exchanging, I was going to say, you really had quite the fortune on you for such a... He straightens his spectacles out. Such a little young person.
I hold the money for the group, so they're not really all mine.
Do you have any interest in banking?
Nah, we move around too much.
Pity. With the initial capital you have there, you could start quite the lucrative loaning business.
I don't know what that means.
You lend money to people who need it, and then they give you the money back, but with interest, for how long it takes them to pay.
That sounds shifty.
It's simply business. In any event, I can't help it if you're not interested. Just seems you're quite young to be dealing with such large sums. It's, well, it's admirable. You got anything to contribute, Raiken?
Not really, no. Okay. He just looks on proudly.
Alrighty.
Raiken doesn't want to get into the money lending business?
Oh, hell no. That would not honor court at all. Unless there is competitions in the money business.
Very good. All right, then. As I said, your business, as long as it takes, he is a very fast counter given how many coins he was handed, will allow you to return to the guild just in time, unless you have somewhere else you'd like to go instead.
About that. No, just kidding.
So, you make your monetary exchange. Your bindles are greatly lightened for having so many fewer coins. At £1 per 50 with 6,000, you are looking at a lot of weight.
Good. We can fit more stuff now.
Alright. Oh goodness, what is all this? I'm just taking care of some PMs from players. So, then, you return to the Mage's Guild. You head inside, and our classic young male half-elf is going to make his way out from his desk and say, "Welcome to the Mage's Guild of Tuka. How can I help you today?" And as he struggles through his words, you can see his eyes linger on Leah. And if we finish, there's just like a pause, and his hand kind of rises absently next to him. He goes, "Hi."
"Hi."
"You were here the other day, weren't you? Night, rather?"
"Yes."
"Never mind. How can I help you today?"
"We're looking for the rest of our group."
"An elf named Laramendus was part of your group?"
Yes.
Okay, I helped him today. I remembered that. Yeah, he's upstairs. I think one of, the other members of your group was, in the corner. He indicates, the direction where Raiken is, reading.
Yukikaze.
I'm sorry.
Raiken is also there reading, just somehow.
You're Raiken, as soon as we walked in, bolted over there.
Da-da-da! Like, there's just a different
Raiken. He saw Yukikaze, he's like, I can't let him beat me in reading.
Yukikaze just looks up from his book momentarily and goes, I didn't know you could read.
I can read and write. It's my brother who can't write.
Can I just stare at him with a very long stare?
Do you in fact break from the group to head over to him first?
No, I did not.
Oh, okay.
But once he sees him, he'll go over there.
Okay, so after he gets pointed out by the young half-elf.
Yes.
Okay, so you go over there, and now he's staring at you over over the top of his book, which seems to be a, from the title on the cover, a journal of an expedition into the Underdark.
Did they put a title on the cover?
Makes it easier to catalog.
For the copy that they made?
Well, yeah. They would make it exactly as they catalog it in their library, just in case it finds its way to another library.
Nice.
Raiken will ask him, so, good read?
What?
I'm asking you, is that book a good read?
It's information. It's more just info than a story.
I mean, it could still be a good read. I mean, if it provides valuable information.
I guess if you're an enthusiast on fauna and, like, geography and stuff, maybe, and...
Oh, boring.
Star spell.
Where's the books on fights?
I don't know. This is the Mage's Guild.
Raiken will go and start searching for any titles that involve fight.
Sam's having a conversation with himself.
And I'm very amused by it.
So, Yukikaze, you seem disinclined to engage Raiken in this discussion of what you're reading. Is that...
Yes, 100%. 100,000%.
I'm sorry, Raiken.
Just rolling my eyes.
It seems that he's not going to give you the responses you're looking for. Are you going to rejoin the group, or are you just going to loom over him?
It's going to loom even closer.
Alex?
I'm back.
Okay. I said it doesn't seem, as you continue to try to engage Yukikaze, that he's going to humor you. All of his answers are evasive, and he seems not to want to talk. So, with that understanding, are you going to return to the group, or are you going to continue to loom over and bother him?
Oh, no. before I started breaking up, I said that Raiken was going to go search for books that, like, with titles that seemed like they would be about fighting.
Oh, okay. You're right. You did say that. I recall that now. Okay. You go on that search. I'm going to tell you right now, it's not going to be fruitful in this place. This place is all about magic.
That's not going to stop him from trying.
I figured it wouldn't, which is why your token's still over there. So, you guys head upstairs, and you find Kalimdar, and Kalimdar greets you and says, yes, you're the professor's traveling companions. Do you wish to speak with him? Jebel Vendar Leah.
Yes, can you bring us to him?
He nods and stands up from his desk, and he will lead you back a couple doors that you would have passed as you were making your way up here to his office. And then he pushes one open and says, here you are, you'll find the professor inside. As you enter, it seems to be a small, smallish, not terribly small, but a smallish room with a bed and a bookshelf and enough space on the floor to do a great many things. In this case, it seems to have been cleared out. There is a person who you do not recognize who is dressed in the robes of the Mage's Guild who is drawing on the floor with chalk. For your information, Laramendus, he is creating the base of the teleportation circle into which you can add the sigils that specify your destination. So he's saving you some time on that. It's very quiet.
So, is Laramendus in the room?
Yes. Sam?
I was muted. I said, that's nice of him. And then I rolled to see if I noticed them come in, and I rolled poorly. So I'm distracted, keeping an eye on what he's doing, making sure that he is doing it correctly.
And of course he is doing this because he is making sure it's being done correctly, so this is just wonderful. All right, then.
The vendor is going to get up right next to Laramendus and then, like, right in his ear. So we ready to go?
There is a bit of a shriek.
The apprentice mage, the journeyman rather, mage, also seems startled by the shriek and, like, clutches his chest. Is a dwarf wearing the cape and cowl of the Mage's Guild. And he looks wildly up at you and just sort of gestures with his hands, you know, one still holding the chalk and covered in dust, like, what the hell?
I imagine we hear a small explosion from the room next door.
The walls are thick enough that it's designed such that if there's an explosion in one room, it's not heard in the other room, because bad things happen when that happens.
It's true.
It's a very well put together building.
It's got the sand above the ceiling.
Yep.
Explosions are unheard of.
There are no explosions.
There has never been a recorded explosion in this building. good. You're here. We should very shortly be, it should very shortly be time to get in touch with Nalia.
It's pretty much time now.
I look around. did you not pick up Yukikaze on the way? And where's Raiken?
They're downstairs. Yukikaze was reading something. I don't know what the hell Raiken started doing.
We need to go.
Well, yours, daughter. Go get him.
No, I'm saying, telling Larmendus, we need to go. We need to leave.
We are going to be making sure that now is an appropriate time. And if it is, we will be going. And if not, we will need to wait until an appropriate time. Could we get the other two of them, please?
I'll go find them.
Whatever expedites this process, this one does not wish to spend any more excessive time in town than she must. And she'll go with you.
So how in your endeavors, excuse me, Vindar?
Yes, what?
I asked how your side of things went.
Well, we got the cart and the Anolian sold, and then we went to the got the money exchange, and I posted a letter, and we're all good to go.
Run into any trouble?
Well, there, a little bit, yeah. I've been exiled from my family, so I need to hide my identity whenever we try to sell anything or interact with any kind of merchant from now on.
Well, if you want to hide your identity, you might want to start by ditching what's currently the most, well, at least to me, the most identifiable thing
I'm not,
about you.
I am not my fucking hat.
I'm just saying, since you're no longer able to trade, if you want the party as a whole to get the best deals, you might want to give it to
trade,
someone else.
And I can still by far get the best deals, we just have to make sure they don't know who I am. And that shouldn't be hard with people who can cast illusion spells.
See, they're called disguise self for a reason. They don't go on you.
Besides, I'm good at disguising myself anyway. I can just do it myself and pretend I'm someone else. It's gonna be the biggest issue in major cities.
So, anywhere we do any shopping?
I'm not giving you my hat.
I'm not asking for the hat. I'm saying, you don't even have to give it to someone else. Simply taking it off might give you a better chance.
No. My hat.
I'd also like to point out,
it's like I'm wearing a hat in the picture she gave out.
I'd also like to point out, there are three people whom you could give the hat to, which would have a much easier time of keeping you alive if they have it.
No. My hat. But I mean, like, effectively, your charisma score is at least 18, right?
No.
Really?
Yep.
Why the hell did you have your charisma so low if that's your spellcasting thing?
Because feats are useful. I have it at 16, which is the highest you could get at character creation, and I haven't had a chance to raise it since. I considered raising it this level, or getting Spell Sniper. I settled on Spell Sniper, but I'm not even saying just me. Like, if you give it to Raiken, that save bonus he gives everyone would go up by one. Which would be very useful. It saved you a number of times.
In my head.
We are going into dangerous places.
And its benefits are rather lost on you now that you've been disgraced.
I disagree.
I understand that.
Moving on.
Okay.
Sure.
I just wanted to make sure that it had all been said. I did just realize that the canvas didn't charge you, and he should have.
Free me!
I was gonna say.
Free service.
But because I wasn't dealing with it.
I mean, so even if he were, like, normally canvas take a percentage, and even if that percentage was 1%, just got to the Thor Ragnarok thing. Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Vendar hiding in plain sight. My disguise is perfect.
Like, I can disguise myself.
I'll
just cover my face.
You just look like you wearing a blanket. Not if I cover my face. It could be anyone. Anyway. Anyway. Even if the canvas only took a 1% cut on the 6,500, that would still be,
sixty-five.
Yeah, 65. So, Leah, if you could do me a favor, and on your sheet, please simply deduct 7 platinum pieces from your total, and then add 5 gold pieces. So remove 7 platinum, add 5 gold.
Okay.
And for Mr. 400, that'll be 4. So, lose 1 platinum, add 6 gold. Okay, Thomas? Thomas?
Done.
Done. Okay, cool. So, yes, sorry. He's charging 1% conversion fee. Alright, then. So, downstairs, the two Dragonborn, Yukikaze is reading his books on the Underdark. Raiken is struggling to find anything about fighting. Every time you think you found something about fighting, it's always about combat magic.
Ugh, that's the worst combat imaginable.
Combat magic, the worst kind of combat.
Describing the use, the strategic use of things like shield and counterspell and then evocation spells that'll give you maximum effect on enemies if they're alone or in groups or intermingled with your party.
And it is written in the driest possible manner.
That's the coward's way out!
Indeed. Your daughter is going to appear at your hip.
We need to go.
Oh, Leah. Oh. Oh, we do? Well, good. This place is full of crappy books.
Those are the best books on magic money can buy, Sonny.
I don't want magic, I want combat.
That's combat magic.
Ah! He's just gonna, like, shove the book that he has into the hole where it was before, and then just be like, all right, let's go. Where are we going? Take me away, Leah.
Bromdor, and now. We need to find Yukikaze as well.
Lin has gone to find Yukikaze. Yukikaze, as you're reading, you're going to become aware of the presence of this tabaxi next to you, as she just slowly leans closer and closer to you until her muzzle is overlapping part of the page.
Oh, hi, Lin.
Hello, Yukikaze. Are you ready? Your friends wish to speak with the Nalia woman.
Ah, sweet. All right, it's time. All right, excuse me a second. I'll pack up and head right on up.
Do you need any help with that?
No, no, it's just a couple books.
I could take one for you.
Just gonna shove it in my bag.
Very well.
So I'm gonna shove my stuff in my bag, sling it over my shoulder, and head upstairs.
She will precede you as she heads over. She's gonna make contact with you, Leah, and just wink as you see that Yukikaze is slowly trudging after her while you're still arguing with Raiken.
Nice.
So they'll head up just moments before you finally get him away from the books. As he slams the book back onto the shelf, the old man who was talking to him, this very elderly looking, anything but frail though, in spite of his voice sounding it, Goliath is going to stomp over to the shelf and say, "Be careful with that! You could damage the knowledge." You reckon?
Oh, sorry. What did you say?
The person who was telling you how useful the book was said, "Be careful with that. You could damage the knowledge," as he came over to the shelf to make sure you had not damaged the book.
My apologies. I'm just a little steamed that there's no actual fighting books.
Perhaps you should learn some magic, and then these books would be of use.
I know magic, but I don't need that kind of magic.
He's going to fawn over the book and make sure that it's okay, so you can take your leave as he's done paying attention to you.
And he will do so.
So, about the time that discussion between Vendar and Cyrus concludes, Lair, the room door is going to open, and Lin and Yukikaze, followed shortly thereafter by Leah and Raiken, are going to enter. And now the room is feeling considerably less roomy.
Excellent, we're all here. Ash? Could you please contact Nalia?
Yes, scholar. Please wait a moment. And he will drift out into the middle of the group and begin glowing brightly. You'll see like little glyphs and like single letters or words in different languages appearing around him made of light and then rising, drifting away and bursting into nothing. And then after a few moments of this, the glow is going to expand and seem like it's trying to shape itself into a face, but you're going to find it never really resolves beyond like an oblong misshapen potato. And from this potato, you're going to hear a crackling, like, you're dropping packets of data, voice clipping its way out, as you can make out most of what Nalia says. You can tell that it's her, but it's the connection is poor. I'm just gonna say, Lair, at you?
Yes. It seems that hopefully just your spell is, influencing the connection, much like the vault. I'm here with my companions and a journeyman mage from the guild who is overseeing the use of magic.
Well, fine on my side. Does it Venation, Jick?
I am unsure exactly the nature of the magic that's being performed. Ash, is this a divination sensor? Should it be affected by a sanctum?
Ash is going to take a moment. And you're going to see, like, the glow forming the potato break a bit, and you're going to see his symbol shining through a dim portion of it. And in his voice, sounding somewhat strained, he'll say, "Portion of the spell I'm using is, in fact, divination, but it is a combination."
That is good to know. Thank you.
Sending is evocation, which is why we can hear most of what's being said. She will not be able to hear your friends, though, because anything that's treated as an audio or visual sensor will not function. At least we will not be able to see it, if she is in a place where that is blocked.
So, I suppose we can't have much of a conversation if you're not coming through to our end, clearly. Do you know if now would be a good time for us to leave?
Now? Good a time? Any.
Excellent.
Dangerous here. Be careful. Circle outside could be detected.
Are there any sensors that exist by the circle that might be keeping an eye on things?
I've or them, but if don't know.
Understood. I think.
Seven. Really losing. And so I was trying hard.
I don't believe we're going to get much more out of this, so I think that now will be when we teleport and we can have a proper discussion inside the sanctum.
Ari. To drop the sanctum.
I don't think dropping it would be a good idea, unless you feel that we need to have more of a conversation before we teleport.
Just be aired the worst.
That seems. I say to everyone, well, that seems reasonable.
Yes.
If he on this, then Jens could at any moment.
I'm assuming that she was saying that if he is watching us teleport, then things could happen at any moment.
Close off.
Excellent. I haven't actually been timing it, so I don't know how close to 5 minutes we are, but...
You've got 20 seconds left.
Claire, we'll see you as soon as the spell finishes.
Okay. Ash's brilliance will come to a climax and then burst out, and he will return to normal and say, "Well, that was informative and unfortunate, scholar."
Indeed.
I have a concern. If we're going to teleport, we're going to come through in one piece, right?
Yeah, most likely.
I don't like the, most likely.
The concern would be more on the amount of time we have on the other end before things of an unfortunate nature happen.
We cannot teleport into a private sanctum, since I believe that is what Yukikaze is afraid of.
Well, no, Isaiah, like, all the scrambling, I didn't want us to come out scrambled on the other side.
Well, that is what I am saying. We will not be teleporting into a private sanctum. It is not possible.
Okay. That's
so good. You do not have to worry about that.
Well, you can pick, you pick the effects of the sanctum. You pick and choose. So you can allow teleportation into it while gaining other effects.
You could. I think that she would just turn them all on.
That is a kind of foolish thing to do. Right, the teleportation circle is outside of the sanctum, which is one of the reasons why she can't be sure that it's not being watched.
Okay, I was just worried because that was all scrambled, and like, I didn't want to come out scrambled on the other side. So, I'm all good.
If the teleportation would fail, it would generally fail in such a way that we would remain here in great pain.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
But not there scrambled.
There's no splinching.
That's good. That's good reassurance. All right, I'm all good. That's the question I had.
Did anyone else have any concerns before I begin the spell?
I just have a couple things I need to consult with Leah about purchasing, along with the head manager's name that I forgot.
Kalimdar.
Oh, the other scroll.
The other scroll, and possibly a scroll of sending, maybe two.
Be quick, please. And I will mute so that the dog will...
The dogs outside the building are getting wild.
Jebel, go tell them to be quiet.
Shut the fuck up!
Oh no, he was talking to Raiken.
Well, yeah, I could use your assistance to purchase a couple things.
Okay, what?
A couple spell scrolls.
How much?
How much was it per scroll, Tristan? I forgot.
It was 125 for the Find Familiar scroll.
At least 125. But I'm not sure exactly how much, so I'd appreciate if you would just come with me. What was that?
Yeah, I'm coming with you, sure.
So I'll go back to Calendar's office, I suppose, or wherever is I need to get in contact with to see about purchasing one more scroll or two.
Alright, you come out of the room. The dwarven journeyman steps out of the room as well, dusting chalk off of his hands, but staying in the doorway to watch the goings-on inside. You two head out and over to Kalimdar's desk. And he looks up from the scroll he's working on and says, yes, the professor's associates again. How can the Mage's Guild be of assistance to you right now?
I need to see about purchasing a scroll of Find Familiar and inquire on if it would be possible to purchase a scroll of Sending, possibly two.
He will pull out his ledger again, and as he sets it down and allows it to fall open, he's going to say, as you know, we have two more scrolls of Find Familiar at 125 gold pieces each. Scrolls of Sending, we've got seven of those, and they are 75 gold pieces each.
Oh, then I would like, assuming it's okay with you, Leah, I'd like three scrolls of Sending and one of Find Familiar.
There's the only problem with it.
That will be 350 gold pieces worth.
Leo, I have about 5 platinum I can put towards this from my own pocket, but the rest I need to come from the bag.
How much is that in platinum?
It needs to be.
In platinum, that'd be 30 plat. if you include his 5 plat.
Okay, then I take off 30 plat from the bag of holding.
Okay. Reduce by 30 plat. And you're going to reduce by 5 plat, Derek.
Yep.
And he will call down for one of the student mages to bring the desired scrolls and transfer them to you.
Nope. Thank you.
Did you use the previous scroll? Are we going to roll with that for now?
I did.
Alright, so you have a dove on your shoulder?
Yep.
It's a small white and gray bird with a pink beak and pink feet. Every now and then it warbles and trills. Looks around very curiously at everything.
Oh, great. Now we have 3 birds.
They're useful.
We have now become the Order of the Sacred Avians.
That can be your new name, so nobody knows. Alright. You have your scrolls.
No one will be able to figure that out.
You have your bird. Definitely. Definitely nobody will figure it out. You go back to the room, and the dwarf watches from the doorway, clearly prepared to cast a spell. Watching warily as Laramendus is going to complete the circle with the proper sigils and begin casting the spell. Or finish casting the spell, as it were.
Works for me.
Yep. I can be unmuted now because the dog is no longer barking.
Okay.
And I will drop my last reagents for that spell.
Okay. So then, you cast this spell. That takes about a minute, right? That's not a 10-minute thing, it's a 1-minute thing.
I believe that is the case. Hold on. Yeah, 1 minute.
Okay. So, you spend a little under a minute, given the pre-setup that the dwarf helped you with, casting. And the circle sigils are going to blaze to brilliant light, coming in gold and silver, and you see a little bit of blue coming through, almost like each chalk line is itself now a window into a world of brilliance beneath the floor. The dazzling light is going to coalesce toward the center of the ring, where it's going to build and build, and then it's going to explode outward, filling the circle to the point that you can no longer make out the sigils at all. It just seems like a blazing ring of light. And within is a swirl of brilliant, vivid colors. And slowly, over the course of several seconds, the image, the interior of the circle, is going to dim and dim until what you can see seems like the browns and whites and reds, and you can see rectangular outlines, rectangular shapes made from these colors, to the point where you cannot see the detail of the area, but you feel like this must be a very hazy, blurry image of a parlor of some kind.
And we all go through. So I step through.
Yes, as soon as the
image... It doesn't take long for the spell to fade, so...
It's true. As soon as the image as soon as the image coalesces, you know that it's safe to step through. It will never get more clear than that blurry image, but you know that once it gets there, you've got 6 seconds to step through.
No, Bendar will step through after...
All together now.
Today is a good day to teleport.
Oh no, I left my foot behind.
Probably follow it also. Right behind.
I assume everyone goes through. Does Lynn go through?
Yes.
Alright, okay. Master Kalimdar, they're finally gone.
I like the question marks.
You could be questioning the question mark.
This is a bit more revealing than I thought.
So, you step through, and after a few seconds of just gut-wrenching, twisting, and turning of your reality, you're going to find solid ground shudderingly under your foot. As you hit the other side, there are stones beneath your feet, and just in front of you, you can see that there is a textile rug on the floor, and standing atop the textile rug are the familiar faces of Nalia and Nerevar. And as soon as you appear, Nalia is going to push her way through the group. Over to Laramendis. She is in summer at the moment. And she's going to throw her arms around Lara's neck and say, after you such trouble with the transmission, I wasn't sure what was going to happen.
I think that that was because of the Sanctum, which would be most interesting to delve into more at a more opportune moment. But it is good to see you.
Look, I expected you to come maybe the next day, you know. Yeah, the day before yesterday. I didn't know you'd spend another two, three days there.
There was just a bit more business to take care of than I had expected. But that is all taken care of. How are things on this end?
She is going to take on a grim cast. And shift into winter. And Nerevar is going to say, not exactly well, Laramendis. We did discover a... what do you call them? The scrying things.
Sensor.
We did discover a sensor before you arrived. And we waited until the portal began to open to destroy it. Because it's not one of hers, so she felt that if they saw you come through, whoever did set it would be upon us, and if we destroyed it, whoever set it would be upon us, but at least that way, they wouldn't know what they were up against.
That seems reasonable to me.
I'm hoping it is. She is going to, kind of separate herself from you enough to look into your eyes. She says, everything's gone crazy, Lair. The drow are everywhere. They're patrolling the cities now. Not just Volinar.
Wait, they're here surface?
He's using them as guards?
Sivan's working with the drow?
He was using them to dig for ores. For the war machine. Apparently, they've had some other duties added, as he is concerned that the military would be spread too thin and he wanted as many able-bodied men in ranks as possible, so many of the city guards were put into service across the borders.
And now he has drow guarding the city?
They're as good as guards to him, she says, stepping away from Lara and clearing her throat. They're slaves, better than guards.
This does not seem like a good idea.
It's not.
Very much doubt they're as loyal as guards.
The whole city's scared. I haven't been informed of any conflicts or confrontations, but damn it, Lair. You know there are elves living here, and they're not going to take this sitting down.
No, I imagine many are quite displeased.
Well, maybe we can use this fact to find somebody to help oppose Seven.
I think we have a lot of ammunition now to deal with Seven with this nonsense.
Oppose Seven? Do you see what he's done? The entire combat force in the cities where you would rally support against him is now directly under his control as slaves. And any good men and women who you might have rallied in the guards are not in the country anymore. This was a calculated move, Lair. The only ones still here are the peasants and the nobles and the drow.
That's gonna make it harder. We still need someone to take over once we get rid of Sivan, though, right?
I don't know who you'll find to do that.
The takeover part is true, but slaves are not a good thing, and depending on the circumstances, we could get them to turn.
You want to...
They're drow, though.
Foment a drow uprising in the city.
No, like...
No.
You're not going to make us any friends.
Not us getting the drow to do stuff for us, but, like, get them...
That still won't end well for anybody. If we get them to turn on Sivan, they're just going to kill everybody.
But then we could take care of the drow.
As you begin having this argument, you're going to suddenly hear the loud, sharp cracking of wood from above you through the ceiling. Several hard crashes with the accompanying splintering, and then the rumble and tumble of heavy wood scattering across the floor, followed by footsteps.
What was that? Someone breaking into the building?
I think that's company.
Should we be expecting a fight?
I can be ready to ambush, but you gotta tell me now.
Nalia is going to shift into Summer and say, oh yeah, it's definitely a fight.
I'm gonna unsummon my familiar, because I want to keep that.
I'm gonna pull my bow, and there's like stairs that they're coming down or something.
Oh yeah, there's stairs. They're gonna be coming down over here. I'm gonna draw that.
Lorelai is going to go invisible.
No, I guess we probably didn't. There's no way to get surprised since they're coming to attack.
I cast Mage Armor.
No, so I'll just be ready to shoot them when they come in. I'll find a good hiding place.
I'm gonna cast Greater Invisibility Twinned on myself and Vendar if possible.
Nope. Not possible.
Alright.
Because they are charging directly down the stairs. Their entry has made it so it's not ambush, but the building is small enough that you do not have time to make spell preparations.
So can I roll hide?
Can you roll hide?
Is there anywhere I can hide in there?
In here? Well, I guess I should get some terrain laid out. So, staircase will be coming down. We'll call... Oops. We'll call this kind of grayish thing here, like a bar counter. Boom. And then there's going to be in brown. No, that's purple. Where's my brown? Is that brown? That looks like brown. It's going to be several scattered boxes. These are going to be like chairs here.
I might use the restroom real quick.
So, each of these things is like a box or crate that likely has, you know, research materials, and it could be books, papers, or like foci or material components for spells. Given that this is a mage's guild, effectively.
It's got the two. Elliot and Claire.
Yeah. It's not... This isn't actually the Mage's Guild for this area.
Yeah, this is her house.
Yeah. As the magical advisor to Lord Sivan.
Yeah.
These could be used for cover. So, Vendar, you could... get behind one of these and roll hide.
Okay, I do.
You will, since that's all gonna still be kind of right up there with I disallowed magical preparation, so same there.
No, so I can't do that before they arrive?
I guess what I could do is, say, make a, an acrobatics. I want to kind of reflect reaction time, so I wanted to say dexterity save, but I think I would say make an acrobatics check to see if you can quickly throw yourself behind something.
DCs. I had a 16.
I'll allow you to move yourself, but the DC to actually get in place was going to be 20, so. Do you want to be behind, whoopsie, like this one that you could get
if
to?
If it was a save, I would have gotten 20.
So, like this one here, like this one here, this one here. That Those one. Are kind of the places. This one here? Alright, so you'll kind of dive over there. You'll,
the one before that one.
Huh? Right there?
The one before that one. It was lagging a bit, right?
Oh, shit. What was this one?
Yes, that one.
Okay. So you're going to shove your way through the group and toss yourself over there. You're not able to roll the hide check yet, but you're there, and you know that you can crouch down, I think I said it right, and roll the hide check. I need to grab the images for these guys. I'll just use a bunch of the same, because these all geards. Not that one. Where'd the... I had the image a moment ago. It was in here. Why did I lose it? Oh, there it is. Alright, and these guys start spilling down the stairs.
Yeah, wouldn't it be funny if one of these looked familiar?
They are all clad in armor, chain and breastplates at least, some maybe half plate. They are all wielding swords and a couple shields with those, all drawn. They are ready for a fight, and you know from the sounds you heard that they busted in that door and they came straight here. There was no hesitation. So they clearly knew where they needed to be. All right, is everyone here?
Yep.
Yep.
All right.
Yeah.
We will get us some music and get ready for some combat.
Dirk's luck is contagious.
Oh boy.
I'm telling you, man, you can never use dice for more than one character. They feel betrayed and will never work for you again.
You just have to make sure that you learn your dice properly. They need to know what happens to them when they roll poorly.
They get the hammer.
I was just about to harken back to that story.
I still want candy dice, so I can be like, you roll poorly, you get dissolved in my mouth now.
I'm still like, I don't know if it was a good idea to really make those to encourage people to put dice in their mouth. Like, somebody's gonna see you eat your candy ones, they're gonna put the plastic one in their mouth, and they're gonna have a problem.
That's their problem, not yours.
I mean,
it just weeds out the stupid people.
We said that about the fucking Tide Pods, too. They're still here and voting.
Turns out there are just too many stupid people.
Yeah, unfortunately, a lot of them. Not all the stupid people.
We underestimated how many
stupid
people there were.
Goodness gracious.
Alright. So I assume we need initiative.
Oops. Yep, please roll it and type it out, and then I will ask for it one by one. Just, making sure that we have some, diversity in the list, considering that we've got, half an hour of fight to do. Okay, that should hopefully...
Raiken going back to Raiken ways.
Do it.
I can't even get a 24.
Yeah. I got rolled a 19.
Turn down the music. Okay. Check.
Plus 5?
I am. I just got my last level up. I got my dex to 20.
Nice.
Okay. That's.
Well, you'll never miss again. Unless the dragon.
Level 46. Okay.
I'm just waiting to see if I can.
Let's see here. Let's see. Sinead.
Yes.
I told you. Back to Raiken ways.
No, not Sinead. It's in Twaysday.
I mean, you could try using like inspiration or something to make it better.
In 92.
Yeah.
Save that inspiration for something more important.
It's just gonna get worse with inspiration. I mean, this is Raiken initiative we're talking about.
All right, Vendar.
24.
Cyrus.
13.
13. Jebel.
11.
11. Yuki.
I'm 10!
10. This is amazing. It's, so far perfect. I don't have to change the order of any names. Leah.
17.
17. Okay, I have to change that one. Raiken.
Sorry.
5.
5, nice. Wouldn't be D&D night if Raiken didn't roll absolute booty. And
my other D20s, I would have had a 16 and a 14.
So you're saying that you chose...
Poorly. I chose the wrong one.
And
so that goes in the bag.
12.
Okay. For those of you wanting to use familiars and shite in this combat, for simplicity, I'm putting them on the same initiative tick as you. So you take your turn, then you tell me what your familiar does. Because, as far as I know, the owl is out, and the raven is out. No, the raven is still put away, because Jebel never said they brought them back.
The owl is out. But it's just easiest to have familiars on the same initiative tick.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is. It's just a pain in the ass. In case you didn't catch it, I said that Lorelei went invisible immediately before.
Lorelei went invisible. Mm-hmm. Okay, so she's doing that thing she did when she got blown up.
Tried to warn you about it.
Yes, but now she's still next to me, though, but it's just...
Okay, so let's rearrange the target immediately. Some of these. Cut that. Paste it here. Cut bad guys. Got not that score. Different score. Cut that. Paste it here. And finally, Leah. Cut that. And paste it here. And then we'll just delete all this empty space. And that should be good. So I'm gonna grab all this.
Do you think the drow would let me take 10 minutes to summon Kubriel?
Probably.
Maybe that's nicely.
I want to put you this way. At least one member of the party won't let you take the 10 minutes. I'm pretty sure the enemies won't either.
Alright. The initiative. Ah, I clicked a thing. That's gonna be bad.
Oh no, now we're at the Player 4 podcast!
Yep. Welcome to the Player 4 podcast, guys. So, what are we talking about this week?
How to Die to Drow. As a matter of fact, it's a showcase. Let's see it.
Shout out to the P4 podcast.
Hashtag P4 podcast. Hashtag P streams.
Oh, God.
What? What?
It's a long story.
It's not that long.
It's too late to go through it.
Okay. Now then. First in initiative is, in fact, Vendar. You have dived behind this small box. And by small box, I mean medium box. Of you don't know what's in it. The askew lid tells you that whatever it is, it's musty. And you are trying to get hidden back there. So, are you going to finish that attempt to hide and then attack, or are you going to do something else?
I'll finish that attempt to hide.
Okay.
It's a nat 20.
Okay, you nat 20 hide, which is a total 30?
33.
That is something else. That is a very high hide. Okay, so you... just these little kicky little feet, like, slither their way back, finish getting behind the box, and he's gone.
Gone.
You are aware of these six drow soldiers that are coming down the stairs. They all have at least partial cover from this box between you and them. Now, with Sharpshooter, I'm pretty sure that doesn't super matter, except for these guys here, the two at the bottom of the stairs, because the box is in fact bigger than them, so they have total cover.
I can't shoot total cover.
No. But these guys here would have had half cover, and these guys here would have had three quarters cover.
Tristan?
What?
Where's the initiative for our friendly NPCs?
Oh, thank you. Let me quickly... Lean I did entirely our... forget them, and I should not. So let me just...
There are three of them.
Especially because there's Narvar, who could probably smite them all with a wink.
Could be. I mean, he's very powerful. I need to go to my characters. characters.
I was thinking about applying poison, but they'll probably all just be dead before I can finish. Before I can shoot if I try that.
Nalia.
Besides, they're drowned. Just kill them and take their poison.
Nalia has initiative. Oh gosh.
Hey, I'll just shoot one of them.
Nalia. 9. And Nerevar will get this guy. And Nerevar nat 20.
So Nerevar actually goes first.
Nerevar should technically go first. He's going to go after you for this round. I'll have him go directly after you, and then I'll have him go first next time. His initiative score is ridiculous. I don't think I want to write that down. I'm just going to write nat 20.
Let me guess. 40-something?
36?
Okay, so not as bad as I thought.
4E was weird.
4E was very interesting. Things basically didn't stop growing, ever. Numbers just kept getting bigger and bigger. But it does matter. He nat 20. Okay, so you hide. That is your bonus action.
What about Lin?
What's his minimum?
What about Lin?
Oh, Lin's
actually.
There's another one.
Damn you all. Too many friends. Lin.
We have friends in low places.
Yeah.
We're in our basement.
Ha. Ha. Lin got a 13. This is way too many people in one initiative.
Indeed. I could fireball them if you want. It might help.
Cyrus, what's your plus two initiative?
I believe it's plus 3.
Okay, she beat you. Now I'll have to actually build a character sheet for her because she was never supposed to get into a fight.
I mean, she could just, like, book it.
She's a thief.
She can't do the worst.
Yes. Alright, So, you did your bonus action. What next? What do you do next?
I'm gonna shoot. I'm gonna shoot one of them. That guy on the top right.
Okay, this guy here.
Shoot him in the snoot.
Yes. I'm going to shoot him with my sharpshooter bonus. So the 17 to hit.
Did you roll with advantage? If you did not, you may.
Oh, yeah, it's a 20 to hit.
20 to hit. That will hit. There is a yelp of pain as your arrow flies from your hidden position behind this box that nobody could have foreseen, and enters his shoulder, at his sword arm shoulder. And what is your damage? More pages to manage.
Poor Nalia. I'm going to either break her house or set it on fire. I'm not sure which.
Please don't break her house or set her house on fire. We are inside of her house.
There's this wonderful little thing that you're taught as a kid called, restraint.
Hey. Wait a minute,
I should have.
So 44 damage. 44 magical piercing damage.
That's a lot of damage. I have to, give me just a second to write out their damage tracks. Okay, so grab soldier 1, going to have. Okay. Soldier 2.
Oh, I'm sorry. It's 39, not 44. 39.
Oh, 39. Okay. And you're double sure?
Yes. I added 15 from the sharpshooter. It's only 10. It's been too long since we fought.
Okay. Not a problem. As long as we got it right now. Just need to write a whole bunch of numbers, which is annoying.
Good. Wall fire doesn't set objects on fire. I could use that.
It's funny because it's super hot and burns people that are on the wrong side of it. But okay. Alright, so that was...
It's weird that it doesn't set things on fire.
Oh, I should go by the... so I don't confuse myself. 2, 3...
Magical fire only hurts organics.
1...
Well, some sets people on fire, some sets objects on fire, some does both. Like fireball.
This is 0.
Okay. Yeah, the spells specify if it sets on fire.
Yep.
Let's edit this.
That's magic for you.
Sorry.
None of the fire spells I have left can set things on fire, which is 1, I believe. Hellish Rebuke. It does not set things on fire. And Prestidigitation, I guess, which can set things on fire, but it's not useful in combat.
And also standing on a bunch of kindling.
Yeah, it's like, I'll light a candle on you.
I will repeat that you are surrounded by wooden boxes, the contents of which you do not know.
Imagine they're full of, like, the gas, the gunpowder, and just... Prestidigitation will light that right up.
That's why I'm trying to find some, building safe spells. Because, something tells me fireball is a bad idea. Also, just because of the size of the room.
Yeah, you definitely hit us.
And, shatter also seems like a bad idea. So that leaves wall fire.
Okay.
You might break the ledger.
Sorry about all that. Okay, so you hit this guy, Drow Soldier 1, and he took 39 points of damage. So we will put that up here. Not there. Where is my bar health? Oh, that's not helpful. Oh, well. Alright, we'll just do it the way I was always going to do it. This way. 39 points of damage is a significant hit. Okay. Boom. Alright, he is crying out in pain as this arrow has pierced the armor at his shoulder, and he nearly stumbles into the soldier next to him as he shrieks. You have a movement action left to you. Vendar.
Can I hide behind the counter?
You're going to dive over this counter?
I can't hide. Yeah, but I can't hide again.
So you can't hide again because you already did it, but you can move there. Do you want to move all the way around, or do you want to dive across it?
Let's dive across it.
Okay, roll acrobatics.
16.
Cool. You make it. You slide over the top of this very nicely polished mahogany wood counter. And onto the other side, you land, crouch down, and you can see that on the shelving here are several glass and ceramic jars and vials with different color tinctures within them.
Okay. Are any of them alchemist fire?
You can check with an arcana roll on your next turn. So we're going to go with it's Nerevar's turn. And he's going to... sigh and say, well, I suppose this was inevitable. Stay close, Cal. And, he's going to draw his sword. And he's going to... Open with a lightning bolt spell.
Ooh, shocking.
Oh, goodness. Now we've got this. Why do I have to choose what app to open? Always open PDF files with Adobe Reader. Why would you ever do anything different? Boom. Excuse you. I don't think that's working correctly. Lightning. Bolt. There we go. For some reason, it was picking up every L-I, even though I had typed out lightning bolt. It's like, no, just find lightning bolt. It's easy. Okay, so he attacks one creature, and then it hits a second creature. Cool. So he is going to roll his int versus their reflex defense. So, Nervar, you rolled meh, which is only a 37. And they rake a dexterity saving throw, which is nowhere near a 37. So that person is going to take 2d6 lightning damage. 6 and 5, he almost maximized. Okay. So he can see these two, so he's going to pick this guy and this guy. So that guy is going to take 11. That can't be right. Plus int modifier. Okay. He's going to take 25 points of damage. Yay, fourth ed. That is 2 and 6. 6 is going to take 1d6, which is 3, 17. Okay, so page of damages. Where are you? There you are. So that is 5 and 6, I said? 2 and 6. 25 and 17. Oh my gosh. 2 is going to take 25 points of damage. And 6 is going to take 17 points of damage. So that was a pretty good opening move for him. And then he's going to, move, here. Okay, so, now it's the bad guy's turn. And these guys, who still have, like, lightning, arcing over their armor, and their shield and weapons, are going to charge forward. At the first people they see, so 2 is going after Yukikaze, because he is big and easily picked out as a target. Yukikaze, you will have your weapons already drawn, because you had that much time before this happened, but not more than that, okay? Okay, so he is going to attack you with a short sword. And he got a 24 to hit.
That'll hit me.
Okay. So he will deal 8 points of non-magical piercing damage. And then he will make an attack with his other short sword. And we'll get a 9. Which will miss.
Yeah, what's the best? Sorry.
Okay. So damage. This guy is going to come in and attack Nalia. Actually, he can be smarter than that. Move into there. He will attack Nalia. He will swing his longsword. And that is a 20 to hit Nalia. Nalia has a 16 AC, so that will hit her. And she will take 1d8 damage from it. 6 points of damage. Okay, that's not so bad. And then this guy will come in to here, and he will attack Nerevar. And that is a 23. Nerevar, AC, that will miss. And then this guy. Boom. This guy is going to attack Jebel. Jebel, this guy has a axe and a shield. It's a 13 to hit you, Jebel.
That should be a miss.
Okay. That'll be it for him for that. Actually, give me just one moment. Maneuvers. You're going to make this difficult for me, aren't you? Okay, instead we'll go sources, player's handbook, classes. Up, 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 up. Alright, where are our thingy-majiggies? Here we go. Yeah, because I feel like there's one Thor. Nope, I'm wrong. Okay, there's nothing he can do. Cool. And then finally, these guys are going to move in here. Alright, that's their turn. Which means it's Leah.
Yes. Let's take a look here. I need to be able to reach some of these guys. I mean, there's so much blocking me. Because I can't fire through, like, I can't cast spells through friendly targets, right? That will be...
Not if they're, like, indirect spells, like fireball, but, like... It just means, if you fire through an ally, it means the ally's gonna grant them cover, unless you have some way of ignoring cover.
Right, yeah.
Like Spell Sniper.
Right, yeah.
Sure.
Spell Sniper only ignores cover on spells that have attack rolls.
Right.
So fireball would still have cover.
But I can move 2 squares to the right, and then have a clear sight for the one attacking Nerevar.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll do you want to do that? There we go.
I move there, and then I will cast... Let's just get it open. I had it open, but then I looked at something else, because I'm an idiot. As a bonus action, I cast Hex.
Bonus action, you cast Hex. Cast Hex. Good God. Yes, you do so. Is there a roll that he has to save against it or anything like that? Or is he just hexed?
It's just... He's hexed.
Okay.
I deal an extra 1d6 necrotic damage when I attack him. And I choose one ability... that he has a disadvantage on ability checks for... So I'm going to choose Dexterity for that, I guess.
Okay. So if he makes a check for Dexterity, he has disadd.
Yeah. Okay. And that's against anyone, not just me. But the necrotic damage is only from me, obviously.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to cast Eldritch Blast, because... That's a cantrip, so I can't cast it after I cast it, a bonus action, yeah.
Yeah, as long as it's a cantrip, you're fine.
Yeah.
So you're targeting Soldier 3.
Yes. Let's just see here. This is so long since I've done this, I had to look at all the details again. Total beams 3, okay. First one was not fun. It was a bit disappointing. And I have. It's. The attack. Spell attack is plus 9, so. 17.
17 to hit 3. Will. Wrong page. 3. 17 will miss.
Okay.
This guy is heavily armored.
Okay. Next attack. 19.
A 19 will hit.
Yay. Okay. Should I roll damage right away, or do you want me to roll the last?
If you
want
to roll the last, that's fine. If you want to roll damage, that's fine.
Okay, then I'm going to roll the last first.
Okay.
Oof. That's a miss.
Okay.
That's a miss.
Alright, then. What's the damage that's from the one that hit?
Okay. So let's see. That's a d10 plus 5, and also the necrotic.
Right. Your hex.
Yes. That was a d6, yes? Let's see.
I think so. I think I still have it open. 1d6 necrotic, yeah.
Yes.
So, d10 plus 5 force, d6 necrotic.
Yes. So that's 10 from 10 force damage and 2 necrotic.
And 2 necrotic. Okay. So your shimmering bolts streak out from your wand, I think it was?
Yes.
Across the room and strike this guy in the back as he's fighting Naravar, who is moving with supernatural grace, almost like he can precisely read the movements of this guy's weapon. And just dodging like something out of the Matrix. Two of your shots unfortunately go wide and miss, dissipating as they strike the stone floor and the wooden ceiling, leaving small scuffs from the force damage. The middle one, however, strikes him directly in the back, and you can see this web of... yours was violet, I think? Purple energy? For your necrotic?
Yeah.
Okay. So this web of purple energy just... pulses out in a ring from the point of contact up over his shoulders into the front. You can see him like arch his back as the bolt strikes him, and the hex takes its toll as you can see like wounds opening on like his face as he's arching back towards you.
Disgusting.
Necrotic damage, man. Okay, after Leah is Lin. Lin is going to disengage and book it. I'll roll it, but... yeah, she did fine. So she literally, like, tumbles backwards away from the person directly in front of her. So they aren't even prepared to slash at her as she suddenly rolls out of their reach, then springs up onto the chairs, where she nimbly, you know, one foot under the next, even as the chair begins to rotate under her, and then she leaps somersaults and lands neatly behind the counter, out of sight. Ravender, you have company.
Yeah. Good hiding place.
Yeah, huh? After Lin is Cyrus.
Alright. Which one looks the most hurt?
The most hurt... this one... let's see. Definitely the one that Vendar shot, which is this one here.
that one there. All right. let me. Want to try and hurry up. Nalia to move, or we'll just block them.
Nalia is not in a great spot right now.
Yeah, but if I what I have to do to get her out is not gonna leave me in much of a great spot either.
Anyway, I think you have Spell Sniper, but if not, they have cover.
I do. I picked it up this level. I'll just try and get them off her by blasting them. So I'm gonna move over to the right side of the room, to the left of the bar.
10 feet.
In line with the in what? In line with the drow.
Okay, so that is here, and then here. 15 feet of movement. Cool.
Yep, works for me. And then I'm gonna cast Sunbeam.
Okay.
Let me pull up its details just to make sure I'm doing this right. This is not one I've used much. Alright, they need to make a constitution saving throw.
Okay, I'm check to see if they have any kind of disadvantage being that it's a sunbeam, but I think they don't.
I'm spreading out sunlight in bright sunlight in a 30-foot radius and additional dim light for 30 feet after that. So they'll have disadvantage on their attacks because of sunlight sensitivity.
Mm-hmm. But they're not they're not at any kind of disadvantage for the save.
I don't believe so, no.
Okay. I wanted to become quieter and it got louder.
Unless they're somehow undead or oozes, they don't have to.
Okay. So con save, you said?
Yes.
Alright, Soldier 5. Soldier 5 got a 20. Soldier 1. Soldier 1 got a 9. Soldier 6 got a 5. So, two fails?
Yep, two fails.
Okay.
So.
What do 1 and 6 take?
You know, I'm just going to try and use the bot real quick. They take 27 points if they fail, they half it if they fail.
Okay, 27 points for one. Okay, and six.
And the ones that fail are blind.
Blind.
Until my next turn.
Blind. And the one that passed is 5. Who takes half of 27, which is 13. 5 takes 13 damage. And is not blind. Okay. This guy dies.
Alright.
Where's my state?
Is that the one dead. I shot?
Yeah, it's the one you shot. He had 11 HP. Which is significantly less than 27. It is also less than 13, so it wouldn't have mattered if he saved.
Alright, and
you can walk off.
I'm going to say I cast that using my meta magic to make it a bonus action.
Okay.
And I'll send out a twin firebolt at the two next to Nalia.
Okay. So you're just blowing a whole bunch of sorcery points right now.
I am flowing.
Three. Yeah, that seems like a bunch to me. I call three a bunch, okay?
It's a quarter of what I have to start out each day with.
That's a bunch. Okay, yeah, so bunch. You twin firebolt.
Yep.
Roll so me some two hits against 6 and 4. Six is blind. You have advantage against him.
Oh, good.
Because it's an unseen attack.
Then that makes it a 20 to hit.
That'll hit.
Alright, which makes it 3. Is this the one that's hurt, or the one that's not?
Soldier 6 is blind, right, so he's hurt, the one that's hurt.
So I need to roll 3d10. And I'll... Actually, I'll hit plus 2. 5. 7. 17. 20 points of fire damage.
Okay, he is super dead. He just... Your firebolt strikes him, and he immediately catches fire, and you just see the fire, it spreads faster than any accelerant that you could have imagined. Like, even if you dashed alcohol on the room, it wouldn't have spread as quickly as it engulfed his body. And even as he raises his weapon against Nalia, completely blinded by the sunbeam you just hit him with, he just rolls aground on the ground and immolates.
Nice.
Right, so 4. What was the to hit?
I'm gonna find out. Gonna use my inspiration on that, because that was sucky.
Okay.
That is, let's see. That's a 21 to hit.
21 will hit.
With 16 points of fire damage.
16 points of fire damage. Okay. Boom. Alright, he takes 16 points of fire damage. Your firebolt strikes him. It does not kill him. This guy is super dead. Dead. This guy's hurt. Two is hurt. Actually, there's nobody here that isn't hurt. Everybody's hurt or dead. Okay. Done with your turn, Cyrus.
Yeah. That'll do.
Okay. Lair! Nalia is still being threatened by the soldier next to her.
Yep. Forced movement wouldn't provoke, right?
Correct. Nobody okay. provokes during forced movement.
So I think I'm going to cast Bigby's Hand.
Okay.
And...
Grab Nalia.
I am going to forceful hand Nalia.
Mm-hmm.
away from danger.
Okay. So,
I can move... Or I suppose I need to make a strength athletics check that I have advantage on.
I believe that is correct. She is not expecting this.
That is unfortunate that I rolled so poorly.
Does she contest it with something? Or is it AC?
Make a check with the hand strength contested by strength athletics check.
Okay, so she has to roll athletics.
What?
You rolled a natural 20!
Okay, that is better than my 12.
Would you...
Wait, no, I didn't get a 12. I got a 15.
15. Almost high enough to beat a 19. Would you like to, like, shout something before you cast this to let her know that she shouldn't resist it?
Yeah. That
okay.
Great.
Okay. It's
don't resist!
It's no action to speak.
Just,
so.
I'm going to move you with Bigby's.
Okay. In that case, she won't resist.
Okay, cool. So she gets moved to behind me, because I can move her.
So it just, like, scoops her up and it can move her around corners and such?
I guess it pushes her.
Okay.
So it can only go in a straight line, probably.
Okay.
So I push her as far back as I can push, which is, because I can push a total of 35 feet.
Okay. Well, at 15 feet in a straight line push, she will hit this box and not be able to move further.
Yeah, so I will
keep squishing
push her
her
to there.
So Bigby's hand suddenly appears over the corpse and just goes, "High five!" And she goes sliding backwards across the floor.
Unfortunately, it doesn't now count as a interposing hand for her. I don't think.
I don't think so, no. But you can always change it later, I think, right?
Interposing hand only works for you.
Oh, okay.
You're not. It's not designed to be able to
help allies.
Provide cover for allies. Mm. So that is my action. When you cast a spell and as a bonus action on your subsequent turns. So, yep. I believe that is that for me. And I suppose I can move one to the left so that if one goes by Jebel.
Okay. Got you. All good?
Yep.
Okay. After Lair is Jebel.
No one has seen me cast the spell before.
Yep, that's new.
What does the hand look like, if you'll allow me to ask?
Like a push.
A large hand of shimmering, translucent force. So, it's kind of hard to focus on.
Yeah.
I suppose.
You're not sure. Maybe she just got hit with a gelatinous cube.
No, because that would have got hit by the light beam. And they would have had disadvantage.
Yeah, I realized I missed an opportunity to impose... anyway. Okay, Jebel.
Okay, so which of these fellows looks the healthiest?
The healthiest? The healthiest out of these.
Probably the
guys.
One in front of him.
There are still four up, right? What the fudge? Why? Seriously. I tried not to, like, get out of the window that I was on, but so I just hovered over the thing and then hovered over that, and it makes the color selection window come up when I do that, so I actually can't see what I was trying to see. It's like, that's dumb. 4, 2, 5, 3... Make sure that my sheet here is reflecting things correctly. 2, 3, 4, 5. Yep. So the healthiest person is 3. This guy over by Narakar. And I think I can put box, token layer, opacity, shitty. And interior light yellow, no exterior. Boom. That's your sunbeam, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Alright, so this guy over here, number 3, is the healthiest Jebel, and he's on the other side of the sunbeam, which doesn't block line of sight, but you've got literally every person else blocking your line of sight to him.
Just so you know, sunbeam is instantaneous.
Mm. Didn't that's it have like some ongoing light effect?
Yeah, I have like a orb, basically, an orb of light in my hand that's going to be shining sunlight over the entire room.
Oh, okay.
Like anywhere within 30 feet of me is sunlight.
Okay. Jebel.
60 feet.
Jebel.
No, only the 30 feet is sunlight.
Okay. Ugh.
No,
Jebel.
Bright and then dim. It's all...
Jebel, please.
Number 3, I'm going to cast Blight.
Okay. And that's a save.
Yeah, let me just double check. Con save. 16.
You got an 11. What happens to him?
Takes 33 necrotic damage.
33 necrotic damage. You raise your staff in both hands and over your head, and this darkness just engulfs the guy momentarily, and as it snakes its way around his body, you see in its wake it leaves this dry, withered, husk-like skin as it pulls the fluid and vitality from him. He is still alive, and he is crying in agony as his ashen black skin is turned into this desiccated brownish husk.
And that is it. That's all.
Okay. After Jebel is Yukikaze.
I'm gonna look at the son of a bitch that attacked me and swing at him.
Okay. What are the weapons you're using? Key and some MR?
Assuming it's an offhand.
Okay. So that is Soldier 2, who's hurt.
Wow, there's something wrong when both dice get the same freaking number. Oh my god, I hate you. Both my damage and my hit were the same. Anyways, it's gonna be 17 to hit for the first two attacks.
17 and something that you know misses? Is that why you're only telling me one? Oh.
No, they're both. I roll multiple dice at a time. So my main hand, two of the attacks.
Okay.
Are 17. So,
because he's a bastard, the guy who's in front of Jebel is going to interpose his shield for one of those two attacks. So roll another d20, and if it is lower, use that. He's making one of your attacks at disadvantage by shielding his friend.
No. Of course, I'm a roller. 15. Roll lower.
Okay, so 2, a 17 and a 15. On 2... The 17 will hit, the 15 will not.
Alright, so that was...
one hit.
One plus six is seven magical piercing.
Seven magical piercing as you stab him with key.
Alright.
He's still standing.
Okay. Mother. Wow, really?
He's looking bloody, so, though.
My key missed... Because I only got a 1, so that puts it at 10.
That's Sumemaru.
No, that's still key. And okay. Then Sume gets... Just remember, because I have triple attack now.
I did forget that.
And so that's a 9, or 10, so that's going to miss. And this is a 24 for Sume.
Sumemaru is going to hit.
And that is a 10... non-magical slashing, and then I'm also pissed that I got blocked, so I'm gonna add a trip attack on that.
Okay, roll a d8 damage. So you said that did 10 points of non-magical slashing?
Yes, okay. 10 points of non-magical slashing.
Okay. The trip attack is gonna deal.
I rolled stupid low, of course. It's 2.
Well, it's still 2 points of damage. He is... not looking great, and he has to make a strength saving throw?
Yep.
Strength saving throw.
Got a mark that I used the dice.
Okay, so this guy, that's going to be a 15.
He fails.
He fails, so he goes prone?
Yep, he goes down. On failure, you get knocked down, target prone.
Okay, blue circle means prone.
Son of a bleep!
So you stab at him three times with key. One of them is blocked, the other misses. One finds purchase, and then pissed off, you spin and sweep low with Sumimaru and take his feet out from under him. He's looking very hurt. Nalia is next. Nalia. Page. Spells. Oh, you have such good cantrips, though. I think that she is going to cast Magic Missile at a high enough level that all four of these guys get hit. Which would be second level. You know what? She's going to make 8 of them. Which is 6th level. Yeah. She's going to cast it at 6th level. Boom. Magic Missile. So they each take 2. 1d4 plus 1. So 2d4 plus 2 for each of them. Not bad. 8 points. 2 points below what she could have done. Alright. So, they each take 8 points of damage. Boop. 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 Yeah. And... boop. Okay, so 2 and 3 die from Magic Missile. Boom. And boom. Magic Missile's scary, Sam.
It's great.
Yeah, so like just...
I mean... after you.
From the ground where she's been shoved back to by the hand... she lifts her implement, and from the end of the rod, just 8 glimmering missiles shoot up toward the ceiling, then spiral around like so many airplanes scattering, and then spray out like a fireworks display before diving down onto their targets, 2 each. Only 2 drow remain. And after Nalia, it is Raiken.
Two remain. Well, first, Raiken must do a little something.
Oh, cough, cough.
Page.
Music.
He will chant gloriously. Ball is y'all. Nisil, Gugnir Tron!
And as before, a shimmering, brilliant silver light bursts from the floor beneath your feet, completely engulfing you, and everyone in the battlefield is aware that you are naked.
Not naked, just silhouetted.
They can't see any details because of the silhouetting.
Can't see the dick.
But they are. There is.
So it's small.
There is no question about just how naked you are.
Deeply aware of the implication.
Deeply. As pieces of armor begin materializing over your body, gloves and boots, quists and cuirass, helmet. After a bare few fractions of a second, you are deposited once more on the ground in full combat regalia.
I haven't been able to wear this for a while.
You have a move and an action.
Raiken will... see.
Raiken will move around to the left of Jebel, next to the one that's in front of him.
Here or here? Do you want to stay next to Jebel?
No. You want to tuck in. Yeah, to the side of the person. Yeah, okay. To the side of the drow.
All right, you tuck in next to the drow. Who still seems to be somewhat dazzled by the light being shed by Cyrus.
Okay.
He was aware enough to interpose his shield and then watched everyone die anyway.
And
he
then
looks horrified.
Raiken will then use let's see. I guess he'll just attack. Yeah, I need this die. Well, he's gonna miss the first attack. Unless 11 hits.
An 11 on 4 will miss.
That's what I figured. He'll attack again.
Okay.
God damn it! 13!
Do you have inspiration you'd like to use?
I do have inspiration. I don't know if I want to use it yet. Right, they're basically dead right now.
Yeah, it's up to you.
I won't use it.
Okay. A 13 will also miss.
So,
do you want to do anything? No, you used your bonus.
No, that's
you used
my bonus,
your action and your move. Yeah, you're out. You want to say anything?
No.
Roar. Okay.
I didn't get to say the day of mine and mess up. I mentioned this.
Which brings us back to Nerevar's turn, who, as that guy falls to Nalia's magic missiles, he's going to maneuver again, moving with supernatural grace. He's going to move around the fallen body and thrust his sword at the drow. Mm-mm-mm. And that means I need this document. You got it right that time. Good job. Okay, so this is intelligence versus reflex. I don't think he can, like, possibly fail this. Again, that's ridiculously high. They roll a dexterity saving throw. That was decent. It's not high enough, but it was a good show that time. The guy almost saw it coming and got out of the way. As this longsword is brought down upon him. It deals 2 weapon damage, which is d8s. 1d8. 2d8. 8 points. 22 points of damage. So, I'm pretty sure. Let's see here. This is, what was that number, guys? Number again? That is 5. 5 is still alive after that hit. Barely. And then, because he hit, he gets to make a secondary attack. Which is really high. The guy has to make a wisdom saving throw. Does not make it at all. The guy is now dazed. Which, I'm not sure if that condition even exists in this edition. Conditions. Doesn't exist. So, we're gonna have to create it. Stunned. There it is. He is incapacitated, he cannot move, cannot speak, only falteringly, automatically fails strength and dex throws, attack rolls against the creature have advantage. Okay, so, this guy is teetering on his feet, barely aware of his surroundings. If you attack him, you have advantage.
Vendor.
So, after Nerevar is Vendar.
Also, he's stunned, so he probably won't get to do anything on his turn anyway.
He was not going to get to do anything on his turn.
So, shoot the one that isn't stunned.
Okay, that makes sense. You can shoot over this box here and into Soldier 4.
Okay. It's a 29 to hit.
That's gonna hit. You have sneak attack because Raiken is right there.
That's 31 magical piercing damage.
31 magical piercing damage. As he's facing down Raiken and Jebel, all of a sudden this arrow whistles over the box and strikes him right in the back of the neck, piercing through his spine, out his throat, and he just sort of... and collapses to the ground in front of you two, choking on his own blood.
How close does this hit Raiken, almost?
The blood?
The blood splashes.
Yeah, the arrow.
The arrow, so it's like it comes through, but it's like it's protruding still, so it's still in him, but you know, it suddenly explodes out through his neck, and it's like it's a distance away from you, but it's sudden and shocking, and a little smatter of blood comes out and sprays across your visor.
Oh, little guy in my mouth.
No. I mean, I guess maybe. You have that transparent visor in front of your face. Just like splattered across that. Good thing you're immune to diseases. Okay, that it for you, Vendor?
Yep.
Okay. Bad guys. This guy is going to disengage and run the hell away.
Wasn't he stunned, though?
Oh, fuck, he is! He can't! It's not his turn! It's Leah! He has no idea what's going on.
Okay.
You have advantage if you attack him.
Yeah, I mean, as a bonus action, I...
hex him.
Change to hex.
Yep.
Because the target was dead.
Yep.
Can I... I mean, the box... How tall is it? Like, can I actually... shoot him from here?
Do you have spell sniper?
No.
Okay, so he has like at least 3/4 cover.
Okay.
But you have advantage. You could move though. Like you're not glued in place. You could move so that he has less cover.
I could shoot out a dead guy, so if I move like 4 squares to the left, I will get down the side.
Like here?
No, to the left. There, yeah.
That'll work.
Is that line of sight there?
Yep.
Yeah, awesome. Then Eldritch Blasts with advantage.
Make it with advantage.
This guy's gonna die.
If he doesn't, I'm gonna try Eldritch Blast. See how that works for me.
There's absolutely no way this man makes it out of this room.
Let's see.
Did you buy Scrolls of Eldritch Blast?
No, I learned it with Spell Sniper.
Oh, okay.
I need something that wasn't, you know, fire.
It's almost like having only one element isn't a good idea.
That's why I haven't. I had Chuck and Grass, I just wanted a ranged attack.
So, 25.
25 to hit this guy in his armor. Oh yeah, that's gonna hit.
Okay, second blast. No, I didn't see what that does.
Remember, you still have advantage. You have advantage on all your attacks.
It's a bit dark here, you see. So when rolling the dice, I had to lift them up. So if I then drop them, I haven't seen the number.
Mm-hmm. I trust you.
Yeah. So okay, I was pretty sure it was taller than that, but whatever. So it's the first one.
Okay.
I'm so bad at this, I don't know what I'm doing.
Just roll with advantage.
No, it's the math.
Oh.
It's the math. 21.
21 will hit.
Yeah, okay.
Third.
Last. 13.
13 will not hit.
Yeah, I mean, that was seriously a 1 and a 4 on the dice. It's like, yeah, okay. Well, I had two good ones.
This is amazing. Absolutely no one was taken down with a melee attack. The spellcasters completely got all the last hits in this, so everyone in here is dead.
So first...
And arrows. I shot one of them through the front.
You're right.
Yeah. First blast is 9 points of force and 2 points of necrotic.
Okay. And next?
Eight points of force and 5 necrotic.
That's ridiculous. Okay.
It's ridiculously low is what it is, because the D10 has not been rolling above 5 every time I've been rolling it today.
I mean,
the D10
eight?
Hates me.
Oh, 3 plus 5. 8?
Yeah.
Okay, well still, that takes him to negative 21 HP, so you reduced this target to 0 while he was hexed, so you get whatever that benefit is.
Is there a benefit to that?
No, there isn't. The benefit is if the target drops to 0 before the spell ends, you can use a bonus action to move it.
Yeah, so there's no more targets. So
I'm just used to thinking that warlocks that hex things get, like, you know, health back or something when they, when they're hexed.
There was a, she had a fiend pact power that did something like that, but that's
probably I think Bane, maybe?
Something like that. I don't know, Fae pact give you that? Anything like that?
No. Not that I've seen.
Okay. Alright, everyone that is not the party or a party ally in this room is dead to either a spell or an arrow. The drow would have fled if he wasn't stunned.
We can't let him get back up.
Indeed.
They all ran down here, and then like 12 seconds later, they were all corpses.
Yeah, not even 12.
I'm not sure they made it to 12.
It was not yet 12. It was like
9.
8 or 9, yeah.
In the midst of it. Didn't even get their 2 turns.
Okay. And I'm going to say, as the smoke here clears, Nalia's going to get up off the floor and say, we should probably leave. And I'm going to end the session there, and we'll pick it up next time.
Whoa.
Can I recover my arrows from their corpses?
Yeah. How many arrows did you fire?
2.
Where's my d6? Yeah, you recover both of them.
Nice.
Okay, so... that was pretty good.
Sunbeam was probably overkill.
There is no overkill. Let me open fire and I need to reload.
Reloading for spellcasters can take a long time.
Yeah.
Alright, XP, huh?
I guess I should turn off the giant. I'm over here, light.
Now just like cover your hand with like a handkerchief. And then just sunbeam out of that.
Just catches fire.
I think I've got a glove or something around here. Oh, hey, look at that. Gloves.
Ba-ba-bum. Okay, everybody's going to be taking 700 experience because that's how the fight XP divided up. Ended up the same as roleplay XP.
700, you said?
Yep, 700.
Alright.
A little more than 15,000 more.
That was not bad. We finally left Tuka And we had a combat. Damn.
But we don't know if Claire's okay.
We don't know if Claire's okay. It's true. She was not in the room, as far as you could see.
I bet she's the one that called him in on us.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, well, hey. Thank y'all for joining me for episode 45 of Everybody Loves Raiken. Join us next week for episode 46.